of the United States space shuttle Atlantis is scheduled to make a second attempt at landing in less than an hour. The crew delivered and installed a $164 million portal for spacewalkers aboard the International Space Station. A line of rain showers prevented the shuttle from landing on Tuesday morning as planned. We will have live coverage when the shuttle lands at the times shown on your screen.
Atlantis Houston, take air data.
Copy, taking air data.
That air data system consists of two probes located on each side of the orbiter's nose, which have pressure ports sensing impact and static pressures at various points to provide information to the general purpose computers regarding airspeed, the Mach numbers, the angle of attack, and the rate of descent. Atlantis now just under 7 minutes from touchdown at the Kennedy Space Center, traveling 2.5 times the speed of sound at an altitude of 87,000 feet, just 75 miles away from the landing strip at the Kennedy Space Center. This first view of Atlantis from infrared cameras at the landing site at the Kennedy Space Center. This view of Atlantis some 69 miles away from runway 15 at the Kennedy Space Center at an altitude of about 14 miles. Atlantis will soon go subsonic, announcing its arrival at the landing site with twin sonic booms.
Atlantis Houston, we see you on energy approaching the hack. No changes to winds or weather. Nominal drag chute deploy.
Copy all.
On final approach to the runway, Atlantis will descend at an angle 7 times steeper than that of a commercial jetliner prior to the flaring of the shuttle's nose by Commander Steve Lindsay to burn off excess speed prior to landing gear deployment. Once deployed by pilot Charlie Hobaugh, Atlantis's drag chute will unfurl almost 90 feet behind the shuttle, helping to slow Atlantis to preserve its tires and brakes. Commander Steve Lindsay has now taken over the flying of Atlantis. Atlantis announcing its arrival with twin sonic booms, now just 7 miles in altitude, approaching the heading alignment circle, which is the mythical point of reference pilots use to align their craft with the runway. Lindsay now beginning to execute an overhead left-hand turn of 241 degrees to align Atlantis with runway 15, the northwest to southeast approach to the 3-mile-long landing strip. Time to touchdown, 2 minutes 55 seconds.
Atlantis, on at the 180.
Copy, on at the 180.
Atlantis, on at the 90.
Roger, on at the 90.
Lindsay now aligning himself and his orbiter with runway 15 at the Kennedy Space Center. Less than 2 minutes from touchdown.
Field site, Houston.
Atlantis, Houston, roger.
This view from the pilot point of view camera, the heads-up display camera, you're looking from the flight deck of Atlantis. This is the view that Commander Steve Lindsay and Pilot Charlie Hobaugh are seeing from the camera on board the flight deck of Atlantis. Steve Lindsay will flare up the orbiter's nose a short time from now. Hobaugh will drop the landing gear. Atlantis will set down on runway 15 to complete this flight. Pre-flare and work. Landing gear down and locked. Main gear touchdown. Drag chute now being deployed. Nose gear touchdown. Atlantis rolling out on runway 15 at the Kennedy Space Center, wrapping up a 5.3 million mile mission to complete phase two of the assembly of the International Space Station.
Houston, roger. That looked like an outstanding landing after an outstanding mission. Well done, Steve, to you and your crew. We'll meet you on page 5-3 for post-landing. We have no deltas.
Copy. We're going to 5-3.
And now we have Space Shuttle Atlantis is getting ready to land at its home base in Florida. Now, the shuttle was supposed to return home Monday, but stormy weather off Cape Canaveral, Florida, forced the U.S. Space Agency to leave Atlantis in space one more day. Now, Atlantis has spent 13 days in space. Its number one objective was to deliver and install a new airlock to the International Space Station. That mission was accomplished, and now so is the landing.
This is the view that Commander Steve Lindsay and pilot Charlie Hobaugh are seeing from the camera on board the flight deck of Atlantis. Steve Lindsay will flare up the orbiter's nose a short time from now. Hobaugh will drop the landing gear. Atlantis will set down on runway 15 to complete this flight.
Space Shuttle Atlantis. Now the five shuttle astronauts once again spent 13 days at the International Space Station attaching a 6.5-ton airlock that was worth $164 million. It was, of course, a very strenuous activity, but the astronauts, they made it, and here we go. We can see them just coming in and about to touch down.
Landing gear down and locked. Main gear touchdown. Drag chute now being deployed. Nose gear touchdown. Atlantis rolling out on runway 15 at the Kennedy Space Center, wrapping up a 5.3 million mile mission to complete phase two of the assembly of the International Space Station.
Welcome home indeed to the five shuttle astronauts who have just come home, have just landed on terra firma. That was Rob Navius. He is the voice of Mission Control.
Welcome back. It's Guillermo Arduino at CNN Center. How are you? Nice landing, nice weather finally. We were not sure about that, and they are finally back here. Let's see what we have in other parts of the country. There are actually some severe weather warnings and watches in effect, especially here in the northern plains and in the Midwest. And also we have a tornado warning in East Montana. We have a front. I'm going to show you. This is the front that is causing the trouble here in eastern sections of Montana. And also severe thunderstorms warning in eastern Montana, in western Kansas, and in northern Nebraska with this other system, the other two. And we have some more here in this section in Iowa, Illinois, and Missouri, parts of these three states, severe thunderstorms watches. So, you know, the most important thing is going on here with a combination of a cold air mass and a warm air mass in the front, so the chance of tornadoes. We'll take a look at this later throughout the day to see what happens. And also the activity is concentrated basically here, and it's going to be moving towards the northeast. So New England states are going to enjoy, especially on Wednesday, nice weather, cooler conditions, but New York City will have to wait, and actually the northeast, parts of the northeast, especially in the south, until Thursday, then the rain is going to bring a relief. So this is an area that is incredibly hot at the moment, and we'll see some activity later, well, with the passing of this front and the rain showers, and all the way into the south. This area here, the deep south and the other parts of the south, are going to be affected by a lot of rain. So a lot of moisture here for a couple of days or so. Also Florida here, we expect more rain showers, especially in the south, with that low pressure center. Let me focus on Delilah, this hurricane here. It's moving away from the coast. It actually brought some rain showers in Socorro Islands, but nothing extraordinary, and it's moving away from the coast, and it's going to encounter cooler conditions, so it's going to be downgraded be downgraded into a tropical storm and eventually start to die down. But it's too soon to tell. We're going to see what happens with this. And in the west, conditions are going to be very nice. This is the only spot in the country that is really nice with dry conditions, especially in the west, not the southwest, where it's going to be extremely hot again. And Texas, Oklahoma are going to be dry. Elsewhere, it's going to be quite rainy. Let's see temperatures. I said New York City 90, so quite miserable.
Die US-Raumfähre Atlantis ist am Morgen sicher auf dem Weltraumbahnhof Cape Canaveral gelandet. Wegen schlechten Wetters allerdings mit einem Tag Verspätung. Die 5 Astronauten waren 13 Tage lang im All. Sie hatten eine Luftschleuse an der internationalen Raumstation ISS installiert. Dadurch kann die Besatzung einfacher als bisher in den Weltraum aussteigen.
Die amerikanische Raumfähre Atlantis ist sicher zur Erde zurückgekehrt. Nach fast 2 Wochen im All landete die Crew am frühen Morgen auf der Piste des Raumfahrtzentrums in Florida. Wegen des schlechten Wetters war die Rückkehr um einen Tag verschoben worden. Die Besatzung hatte erfolgreich eine Luftschleuse zur internationalen Raumstation ISS gebracht.
What is harder to predict is how far the lava will reach. Bill Neely has that report.
Mount Etna is cracking open. Spectacular from afar, breathtaking from close in. Europe's most active volcano is spewing lava and ash and deadly gases, tearing the earth apart. We're now right in the middle of the biggest eruption for a decade, maybe more. There are explosions every few seconds from the two craters behind me. It sounds a bit like a war. The air is filled with ash and with a smell of burning matches. In fact, it's this, a river of red-hot lava that's now flowing really quite quickly down the volcano towards the town. It's 1,000 degrees centigrade, and underneath it and underneath me is a huge lake of molten rock. They call it liquid fire, but some of it, spewed up by the earth, is the size of a car. Nothing can survive in its path. The volcano experts are watching it closely, some far too closely. But for the past 3 days, it's been irresistible. A new crack that has grown and grown, the rim of the crater collapsing into the volcano. A chain reaction with more and more energy released. This lava flow is being tracked by satellite, but down in the valley town of Nicolosi, they're worried. The lava may be 2 miles away, but in 2 weeks, things may be much worse. No one knows when this will stop.
Maybe we'll stop in 1 week, we'll stop in 2 days, we'll stop tonight. Maybe we'll last for 1 year, for 6 months.
Nobody knows.
Nobody knows.
For now, they're trying to douse the lava with water, but most of these efforts look puny in the face of the most vicious and dramatic time bomb in nature. The pyrotechnic fury goes on. Bill Neely, ITN, on Mount Etna, Sicily.
Found at Florida's Kennedy Space Center. It was a rare night landing that ended the shuttle's 13-day mission to the International Space Station. The risk of bad weather had delayed the landing by 1 day. The 5 Atlantis astronauts delivered and installed a new $164 million airlock on the space station. And this is news just coming in.
Gear touchdown. Drag chute now being deployed.
Nach fast 2 Wochen im All landete die amerikanische Raumfähre in Florida. Die 5-köpfige Crew hatte eine Luftschleuse an der internationalen Raumstation ISS montiert. Durch diese kann die Besatzung der ISS jetzt direkt ins All gelangen. Bisher war das nur über ein angedocktes Shuttle möglich.
Like a magnificent ballet of nature, Italy's Mount Etna volcano put on a fiery spectacular, spewing boiling streams of lava up to a kilometer high in the dark skies over eastern Sicily. Geologists and civil protection officials said Wednesday the threat to nearby villages and towns has eased for the time being, allowing tourists and residents the rare opportunity to marvel at the fiery display. The last time Europe's most active volcano posed a threat to nearby residents was back in 1992.
Nun hat sich der Vulkan etwas beruhigt. Die Lavafront ist praktisch stehen geblieben. Doch das dramatische Schauspiel am Etna ist noch nicht vorbei. Claudia Rödel berichtet.
Der Etna, ein gigantischer Schlot. Tonnen von Rauch und Staub katapultiert der Vulkan in die Luft. Dazwischen spuckt er immer wieder Fontänen mit Gesteinsbrocken aus dem Inneren der Erde. Der Vulkan brüllt, so sagen die Menschen hier. Der Staub überzieht die ganze Ortschaft Nicolosi am Fuße des Etna mit einer dicken schwarzen Schicht.
Man kehrt morgens, man kehrt mittags und man kehrt abends. Und der Schmutz ist immer wieder zu finden. Man kann keine Wäsche raushängen. Das ist schon sehr, sehr störend. Vor allen Dingen die Wohnung, man trägt es in die Wohnung rein. Und es dauert etwas, bis man das wieder sauber hat.
Gefährlicher als der Schmutz ist jedoch das Schwefeldioxid. Das Gas ist in dem schwarzen Rauch in großen Mengen enthalten. Es verbindet sich mit der Luft und wird zu Schwefelsäure. Als saurer Regen kehrt die giftige Substanz wieder auf die Erde zurück, schadet dem Boden und den Pflanzen. Doch auch eine ganz direkte Gefahr bedroht die Region weiter. Die Erdbeben, die den Vulkanausbrüchen folgen können. Die Menschen von Nicolosi sind noch nicht in Sicherheit.
Rückkehr. Die US-Raumfähre Atlantis ist wieder in Cape Canaveral gelandet. Sie war knapp 2 Wochen im All. Gemeinsam mit der Besatzung der Internationalen Raumstation hatten die Astronauten eine neue Luftschleuse an der ISS montiert. Die 200 Milliarden Mark teure Station soll 2006 fertiggestellt sein. Wegen schlechten Wetters war die Landung der Atlantis um einen Tag verschoben worden.
Im All ist die amerikanische Raumfähre Atlantis in der Nacht sicher in Cape Canaveral in Florida gelandet. An Bord 5 Astronauten, die gemeinsam mit der Besatzung der Internationalen Raumstation ISS eine Luftschleuse installiert hatten. Die Schleuse ermöglicht es der ISS-Crew erstmals, die Station jederzeit zu verlassen. Die ursprünglich für gestern geplante Rückkehr war wegen starker Winde um einen Tag verschoben worden.
Also es ist wirklich einigermaßen entspannt mittlerweile, obwohl der Hauptkrater, der spuckt immer noch gewaltig viel Gestein und Asche aus. Und es ist doch nach wie vor ein sehr eindrucksvolles Schauspiel, wenn man dort hinaufschaut und immer noch sieht, wie da diese Brocken hochfliegen mit der unwahrscheinlichen Wucht. Aber sie fliegen nicht mehr so hoch wie gestern und in den vergangenen Tagen. Man spürt deutlich, dass es etwas ruhiger geworden ist hier. Und die Lavaströme, diese beiden gefährlichen Lavaströme, die die Orte Nicolosi und die umgebenden Ortschaften bedroht haben, die sind tatsächlich zum Stillstand gekommen.
Wird denn jetzt schon erste Bilanz gezogen von diesem Ausbruch?
Naja, eine erste Bilanz wird noch nicht richtig gezogen, eine erste Schadensbilanz eigentlich noch nicht richtig. Auf jeden Fall hat die italienische Regierung schon mal 20 Millionen Mark bereitgestellt, damit hier wieder ein bisschen aufgeräumt werden kann und damit die Schäden in Grenzen gehalten werden können. Es ist ja noch nicht vorbei, das Ganze. Es gibt immer noch ein bisschen geteilte Meinungen darüber, ob das, was wir jetzt erleben, nur eine Atempause ist oder ob das die berühmte Ruhe vor dem Sturm ist und irgendwann demnächst das Ding erst richtig losgeht, obwohl doch es eine einhellige Meinung gibt, dass es etwas ruhiger geworden ist, dass der Druck, der ganz von unten da hochgekommen ist, dass dieser Druck ein bisschen nachgelassen hat, dadurch natürlich auch der Pegel des Magmas ein bisschen sich gesenkt hat, dadurch das Ganze etwas ruhiger geworden ist. Aber es ist eine Gefahr. Es sind oder 2 größere Gefahren. Einmal sind hier doch 2 sehr, sehr große Risse entstanden. Die sind im Moment wieder geschlossen. Aber einer hat mir heute gesagt, es könnte durchaus sein, dass irgendwann bei einer nächsten Eruption der Berg da richtig ein Stück abreißen könnte. Noch, es ist nicht so weit, aber es kann sein. Und die andere Gefahr ist natürlich, dass die flüssige, immer noch heiße Lava, die unter der mittlerweile erstarrten Strömen hindurchfließt, sich einen Weg bahnt und da unten irgendwo explodiert. Ob das geschieht, wann das geschieht, keine Ahnung. Die Experten haben darauf auch keine Antwort.
Martin Pendel, vielen Dank.
Der Ätna spuckt wieder mehr Asche und Lava, doch die größte Gefahr für die Menschen am Berg ist vorerst gebannt. Vor allem der Lavastrom, der die Ortschaften am Fuße des Vulkans bedroht, ist deutlich langsamer geworden. Ein Mitarbeiter des Zivilschutzes auf Sizilien sagte, die Lava werde noch 100 Meter zurücklegen und dann stehen bleiben. Dennoch gehen die Eruptionen weiter, der Vulkan speit aber weniger Asche und Lava aus als in den vergangenen Tagen. Nach Angaben der Behörden ist die Situation unter Kontrolle.
Here we are arriving at the Cape for launch. We typically fly down in T-38s, and there we are just kind of taxiing in formation. This is our vehicle out on the pad at night, right after we first get there. So we'll pull up in our airplanes and talk to the press a little bit, and then get ready for a couple days prior to launch and kind of get settled in. Here we are on launch day, getting into our suits. We get in our suit, do a pressure check. They said they couldn't find any videos of me smiling. That's because I didn't smile until we finished the mission. Charlie, on the other hand, is happy to be on his first flight. He's getting ready here, getting his suit all checked out, ready to go. Mike Gernhardt, who was, this is actually a shot from a NBL run, but here he is getting strapped in. And we're all in a suit room right there at Kennedy Space Center. Janet doing some training to fly the robotic arm, and she'll be getting suited up. She's ready to go on her third flight. She's a veteran. She has no worries at all. She didn't know me that well then. And finally, Jim Riley here he's getting into an EVA suit to practice a water run. And Jim getting suited up. A few months before the flight, they made him an honorary U.S. Marshal.
Barney Fife.
I guess I don't need to say anything else. Here we are on walkout. Same criteria as before, as I mentioned. Key is not to fall down. Keep a tight formation. Don't put your hand in the other person's face. Go out to the vehicle, and we go out there about 2.5 hours prior to launch and get strapped in. I'm the first one to go in, get my harness on and parachute, crawl in. Vehicle's in a vertical, so the back wall is actually the floor. To get in my seat, I have to do a pull-up and get into my seat. They push me down my parachute, get me strapped in. Here's a neat shot from the mid-deck. This is Jim getting into his seat. He's actually using the back wall to step on and to get into his seat. And notice he's riding all by himself down there. Into the right seat is Charlie. Same process as I used to get into his seat, getting strapped in. Mike's already in right here. And then finally, Janet's the last one in. She's in the vehicle about 2 hours prior to launch. Once she gets in, they'll close the hatch, do some leak checks, move everybody well away from the launch pad, 2 or 3 miles away, and then we're getting ready to launch. Now let's you listen to the sound. Looks like from the inside. The first couple of minutes, pretty rough ride on these solid rocket boosters. About 2 minutes into the flight, we get up to about 4,000 miles an hour, and the solid rockets are going to come off here. And there they are separating. And pretty big flash in the window when that happens. And there they are separating off the vehicle. And the vehicle goes away. Neat shot here coming up of what the SRB looks like from the ground. You see, is it tumbling back to Earth? And then it's about another 6.5 minutes, a very smooth ride up into space. Once we hit space, the last thing we do is we drop off the external tank, and it'll re-enter the atmosphere over the Pacific Ocean and burn up.
As we get up on orbit, there's a lot of work that needs to be done. We start off right with a payload bay door opening to get some cooling going, and then deploying the KU antenna shown here, which gives us some comm and video. And then it's also configuring the flight deck. We need to get rid of all our ascent stuff, pull out all our orbit books, and get prepared for docking the next day. Here's Mike also getting ready for an EVA. He's got his drink bag, and part of what comes out besides the water is a little bit of hydrogen or air, and that needs to be liberated. Here, coming up on the rendezvous, was a shot from the station, and then how the actual profile looks relative to the station. We approach from underneath, transition out in front, and approach right down the line of sight, and then we dock to the mating adapter, which is attached to the lab. Here's how we're set up on the flight deck with Steve and Jim in the back, and also Janet. She's running the docking mechanism. And here's what we look like to station as we're coming up on along their line of sight, and what station looked like to us out the back window. Here's our payload bay with, again, the gas tanks and the airlock that you've already heard about. And Steve, the excitement gets a little closer. Janet's getting ready to run the mechanism, and Jim's shooting the handheld laser. Now, if we saw this happening in this kind of time, we'd all be screaming at Steve. This is like twice real time, but this is a perfect dock. And then the obligatory high fives for a job well done. This is a really good job on the docking. The next thing after mating is getting some leak checks between the two modules. We get to stare at each other through this 2-inch window, which is pretty exciting. And you know, it's kind of like, let me in, let me in. And this is an awkward situation here. It's like, how do you hug a guy when you're upside down, the other guy's right side up, and you don't know which one's which? That's Steve and Yuri exchanging congratulations. And again, none of us had been in station before. This is Steve coming into the station for the first time. It's got that new car smell to it. It's a little different.
One of the real challenges we had for the first EVA is that we had an integrated operation with the station crew and us, and we hadn't trained with them for 4 months. And this just shows the pre-flight briefing that we did. We spent about an hour going through all of the different dependencies of the two robot arms. Here's Susan actually operating the station robot arm, while Janet and Steve were back on the shuttle operating the shuttle arm. And again, this was the first use of the station arm, and with its sort of slow start with respect to some of the computer problems, we were prepared for any number of different contingencies that could go wrong. And Jim and I were down in the payload bay preparing the airlock for unberthing. And this is a shot of Jim installing his foot restraint. Jim was working on the arm, and I'm down here, you see in the lower part of the screen, releasing a cable. And this is just a graphic depiction of taking the airlock up there. And Jim and I had really tight choreography. As I mentioned before, we were a race against time for the water lines freezing up or our suits running out of consumables. And the choreography worked out so well that actually when I released this cable and went to hand it up to Jim, he was actually coming by on the arm, and I handed it off to him on the fly. And so we actually had our times down within, you know, literally seconds of what we had hoped for. And then this is Susan getting ready to mate the airlock to the CBMs. Jim and I went up there, and we're in position to give her guidance commands if she needed them. And then once the airlock was attached, Jim and I got busy with hooking up the heater cables and then preparing some of the fixtures for the next EVA. And this is us coming back at the end of EVA 1.
As with all other modules on the space station, ours was given a name, and here it's being christened as the Quest module. We are not responsible for that name. Headquarters is, so you'll have to ask them. This is again showing the vestibule outfitting, where we're taking some of these lines and connecting the airlock to the space station itself. You see Jim Boss there helping us out, and Yuri, as I said before, we're operating as one team there. A lot of the stuff going on inside, but here we have a very nice picture of Italy there in the background. You can see the boot there at the bottom. Now we're getting prepared for EVA 2, and as we've been mentioning all along, it was quite a choreograph between the two arms moving at the same time. We have one stowed over there, the shuttle arm, as you see, while the space station arm is getting ready to hand off the tank to the space station, or to the EVA guys. But in reality, we had both arms moving at the same time. And you see the shuttle arm over there on the left side. The station arm is now coming in for the grapple for the first tank. And now both arms are moving. Mike is on the shuttle arm over there coming up, while Susan is moving the first gas tank up to position. Mike is now there near the top, getting ready to jump off, climb on over to the node, and then on over to the airlock, where he and Jim will accept this tank.
And as you saw earlier in the slides, here's another shot of Mike and I taking the handoff from the arm, and here's the arm actually pulling away, and right at this moment we've got the tank in our hands ourselves, and we're the only ones holding on to it, and we're bringing it down onto the latches. This is also like the docking. We would have been screaming at each other if it had gone that fast, but we'd sped it up a little bit. Once we got it attached and locked down, then Mike opened up the valve that flowed the gas to the station, so the nitrogen and oxygen was now available. While he was doing that, I went off to get the next site for the next tank ready for the next delivery. And as you can see here, we've got in EVA 2, we had the opportunity to get two tanks on, which was a nominal plan, and we had enough time to get a third one on, which gave us a little extra time on EVA 3. And then as we finished up the day, this is a nice view looking up into the terminator of the Earth. Now, once we got on orbit, it's time to outfit the airlock. And here's the crew opening up, and as you can see, there's a lot of stuff in the crew lock right now. We still had a lot of outfitting to do. Mike's in the crew lock. We've got the crew lock bags with all of our tools in it. And then it was time to get ready for EVA 3. And Scorch here, as we mentioned earlier, was our choreographer on all of this. He was suiting us up, making sure we had all of our tools, making sure all of our systems were ready, making sure we were ready. Turning on all of our equipment on the suit as we're getting ready to go out the door. And then as he stuffed us into the crew lock, he shook our hands. There I am with my head toward the equipment lock, and Mike's got his head up to the other side.
And we almost took Scorch with us, but he's a little bigger than both of us. So he closed the door, shut the garage door on us here. We depressed the airlock and then started EVA 3. And as you can see, that on EVA 3, we were putting the last of the tanks on. Again, this is animation of the station robotic arm as it's bringing the third tank up. And Mike?
Yeah, this is a view from the elbow camera of the shuttle arm that traces the trajectory that the station arm would make with the high-pressure gas tanks. And then up in the far left corner of the screen, you can see the hatch. And as it turned out, we were delayed a day because of outfitting issues. And we ended up coming out the door on the same day of the anniversary of the first moonwalk, which we didn't even know until the Capcom made a speech about that. And this is a shot of me coming out of the airlock. One of the neat things about this airlock is you come out and you're facing straight down. So as you exit in the shuttle, you go into a nice payload bay, and here you're dropping straight down. Looks like you're skydiving from 250 miles up in orbit. And if that scares you, you can quickly switch your reference frame and look at structure. This is a shot from my helmet camera, which we also called the monkey cameras. But here we are looking straight down at the payload bay. This is me riding the arm down to release the gas tank. And then on the inside, Susan and Yuri were busy flying the SS or the station RMS. Here's a shot of Jim and I removing a thermal cover that was on the airlock to keep it warm until we got ready to get the tanks. And when the tank was about 10 minutes away, they gave us a call and we removed the thermal cover. And here we are taking the handoff of the tank. And then after that, we scaled the truss to go up and look at the solar arrays. And here's Jim and I flying in formation. We didn't train heavily on this task, and there's a whole bunch of little things that you could really mess up there. So we were very careful to move slow and not undo the success of the first two spacewalks.
So after 9 or 10 days of really full schedules and hardly ever going to bed on time, we decided it was time to have a little party. We went over to the SM module. It was bedtime, but it was well worth it to go ahead and have a meal together, kind of a celebratory event after making sure that everything was done properly, everything worked, and so everybody was very relaxed, and so we had a really nice meal on station with mostly the Russian food, which is just excellent. If you haven't seen the water bubble tricks, this is an astronaut's prime means of enjoyment, space here, entertainment. You can see the air bubble trapped inside a water bubble here. You can see Steve's face is upside down there on the outer water bubble, but on the inside, in the air, he's right side up again. So Yuri's taking some dental floss here and removing that air bubble outside the water bubble. Now you see the inverted pictures again of the people in the background. And if you don't get out of the way of that water bubble in time and you take it right in the face, it's quite a shock. Anyway, this is what it looks like if you're doing a fire drill on the space station, taking a tour from the SM module through the FGB, where you can see all our transfer items here waiting to be transferred back to the shuttle. Skimming through this long, skinny module, the Russian module is right below us there, going right now into the node. We're going to take a quick peek to the airlock to the right and back right through into the lab. And if you keep going straight through, you'll end up inside the shuttle.
This was a sad part of the flight. You know, it almost brought a tear to my eye anyhow. This is the final farewell to the Increment 2 and our stay aboard station. This is a before of a before and after shot. This is the two pieces together. And this shows, if I would have done it right, what it was supposed to look like. It actually went pretty well. But we fly out along a line of sight, pretty much a reverse of how we came in, out to about 400 feet, and then we do this circle more like an egg all the way around the station. We survey all the parts and take a look at it from all different angles until it gets really dark and scary. There's a docking target on the left, and then our mating mechanism starting to separate. You can see a little bit of ice bouncing away here, that, or they were throwing coins at us from the station as we separated. And here's the flight deck. Like I said, this time I got to swap with Steve, and he's over on the left-hand side screaming at me the whole time. Yeah. Here we are separating out. There's Jim's big head. I couldn't see anything, so I'm just trying to sneak a peek under that big old thing. And Janet's keeping us all straight. Here's what the station looked like to us as we're separating out again through our centerline camera out of our docking mechanism. And Steve getting a good look of what it looks like. And then as we do the fly around, you can see this is like a rear aspect of it. And then here we start phasing into nighttime, and it got just about that dark.
After we completed our fly around, it's time to take a couple of last looks at the planet, time to close up the payload bay doors and come on home. We had two shots at on the first day. We didn't get either one of those, but we did on the second day. We hit the upper atmosphere at about 400,000 feet, and here's what you see through the overhead windows. We get the flash of the plasma, and then you can see that in the back of Steve's helmet there, and then on the outside of the windows on the other side of Steve is the plasma that we're flying through when we're up high. Here's a thermal image of us as we're coming down. You can see just how hot the orbiter is. This is the HUD view that the pilot sees. This is the one I was looking at too. I had a repeater screen that I could look at, and what you can see is we're rolling out on final approach here. You can see at the top of the screen the runway. Here's another thermal image, and you can see just how hot the nose is relative to everything else on the vehicle. We're starting to do our pre-flare and the final flare. The gear's coming here in a second, and then we will touch down at just a little bit over the speed of a 747. And you see the aim point that Steve's heading for right there, and as we're coming through the lights, you can see the condensation over the wings and over the top of the cockpit. It was a perfect touchdown. We could almost not feel it. It was just about perfect. Scorch deployed the chute. It came out. We dropped the chute at about 60 knots. We roll out on the runway after roughly 5.3 million miles, almost 13 days on orbit and 200 revolutions.
Well, once we land and stop, our job's not done. We have to reconfigure the vehicle one more time to turn it over to the ground team, get cooling on it, and reconfigure the computers. And it takes about an hour to get out of the vehicle, and they check us out, make sure we're okay. And here we are. The last thing we get to do is crawl out of the vehicle, do a walk around, take a look at the vehicle. There's the Kennedy Space Center director telling me I'll never fly again. So we meet and greet, especially the folks at Kennedy Space Center. We flew this vehicle for 13 days and never had a single problem with it, and never had to worry about it, and just everything worked perfectly. It was just a wonderful vehicle. They did a great job for us. And that's pretty much the end, and due to budget cuts, they had to turn out the lights on the runway right here. And that's all we have.
Discover why it was one small step for man and one giant leap for mankind. You join a bus tour of the complex, which includes all the visitor areas. This, for me, will go down as one of life's experiences. Even as a small child, I knew about NASA, I knew about the Kennedy Space Center, I knew about Cape Canaveral, but I never thought I'd be standing here. You can forget the big bands, the razzmatazz, because this is real, a piece of history. This is where the first man on the moon took off, and it truly is awesome. At the Apollo Saturn V Center, you can relive the launch of the Apollo moon mission. To say really, other than the really magical thing about this place is that nothing is mocked up, everything is completely real, and that's a real space rocket. It's mind-blowing. So why build the Kennedy Space Center here? Well, one of the reasons is because of the good all year round weather. But I wonder, if you're coming to Florida, what kind of weather can you expect? Between July and September, Orlando can reach 37 Celsius, that's 100 degrees Fahrenheit, with humidity of 100%. The wettest month is September, but from October to May, it's worth remembering that the temperature can often drop to 15 Celsius. So remember to come prepared.
Noch immer nicht beruhigt. Die Lava fließt und fließt und richtet mittlerweile beachtliche Schäden an. Immer weiter schieben sich die Massen den Berg hinunter. Der Lavastrom kommt der Talstation der Ätnabahn und den Gebäuden drumherum schon bedrohlich nahe.
Als hole er alles aus seinem Innern, was er zu bieten habe. 500 Meter hoch schießen die Lavafontänen aus dem Ätna. An solche Ausbrüche können sich die Sizilianer schon lange nicht mehr erinnern. Bei Tag zeigte sich die Bergbahnstation Sapienza schon schier umschlungen von grauschwarzer, dampfender Lava. Schutzwälle sollen den Lavastrom abdrängen, der die Hütten und Restaurants des Ausflugsziels in knapp 2000 Meter Höhe zu verschlingen droht. Resignation macht sich breit. Das kommt nie zum Stillstand. Ich denke, wir befinden uns mitten in der zweiten Ausbruchsphase. 800 Meter höher blubbert der Ätna ohne Unterlass Lava aus. Wie Pulsschläge aus dem Erdinnern. Schneller und mit mehr Druck als erwartet fließt die Lava talwärts. Am Vorabend kam sie schon an der Talstation an. Mit Bulldozern und Planierraupen konnten Einsatzkräfte vom Zivilschutz und Heer bisher die glühende Masse abdrängen. Der Feuerberg hat wieder einmal bewiesen, wie unberechenbar er ist. Aber mit einem schier unglaublichen Feuerwerk macht der Ätna die Schäden, die er anrichtet, fast wieder wett.
Und hier ist wieder Galileo. Willkommen zurück. Ich habe jetzt eine gute Nachricht für alle Verliebten und Weltallfans. Die kommenden Sommernächte versprechen, ab der kommenden Woche besonders romantisch zu werden. Und viele Wünsche gehen in Erfüllung. Vom nächtlichen Sommerhimmel wird es nämlich Sternschnuppen regnen. Vor allem um die Zeit um Mitternacht werden sie besonders gut zu sehen sein. Also achten Sie auf den Himmel.
Pro Stunde bis zu 100 Sternschnuppen. Sie stammen aus dem Schweif des Kometen Swift-Tuttle. Jedes Jahr im August kreuzt er die Umlaufbahn der Erde. Der Komet kommt aus dem Sternbild Perseus. Deshalb werden die winzigen Gesteinsteilchen seines Schweifes Perseiden genannt. Den Schweif hat der Komet nur, solange er der Sonne nahe ist. Durch die Hitze schmilzt das Eis in seinem Kern und treibt als Gas ins All. Die meisten Perseiden sind nur wenige Millimeter groß, aber wahre Energiebündel. Sie schießen durchs All mit 250.000 Stundenkilometern. Zum Vergleich: Eine Pistolenkugel erreicht 8.000 Stundenkilometer. Wenn die Perseiden in die Erdatmosphäre eindringen, bringen sie Luftteilchen zum Leuchten durch die Reibung. Die Mitarbeiter in den Satellitenkontrollzentren sind über den Sternschnuppenregen keineswegs erfreut. Denn für Satelliten sind die Perseiden eine unberechenbare Gefahr. Sie können die Elektronik lahmlegen und die Außenhaut zerstören. Mehr als 600 Satelliten umrunden die Erde. Sie sind so ausgerichtet, dass sie kaum Angriffsfläche bieten. Der Sternschnuppenregen im August. Ein seltenes Naturschauspiel. Am hellsten leuchten die Sternschnuppen in den Stunden nach Mitternacht.
Umgangssprachlich heißen die Perseiden übrigens Laurentius-Tränen, nach dem Märtyrer, der im 3. Jahrhundert nach Christus auf einem glühenden Rost zu Tode gefoltert wurde. In diesem Sinne kommen Sie gut durchs Wochenende und beim Grillen nicht auf falsche Ideen. Ich wünsche Ihnen viele Sternschnuppen und eine erholsame Zeit. Und ich habe jetzt auch ein paar Tage frei.
Gegen die Lava mussten die Einsatzkräfte am Ätna in der vergangenen Nacht eine Niederlage einstecken. Die glühenden Gesteinsmassen haben die Seilbahn im Skigebiet nördlich von Nicolosi plattgewalzt. Masten knickten wie Streichhölzer, Gondeln schmolzen dahin. Trotz des Einsatzes von schwerem Räumgerät war es nicht gelungen, dem Lavastrom eine andere Richtung zu geben. Viele Menschen in der Vulkanregion fürchten um ihre Existenz.
Am 12. Juli startete die europäische Rakete Ariane 5 und an Bord der Satellit Artemis. Und das Besondere an Artemis ist sein Innenleben, das sogenannte Ionentriebwerk. Mit ihm soll es demnächst möglich sein, noch viel weiter als bis zum Mond zu fliegen. Doch jetzt beim Premierenflug, da gab es jede Menge Schwierigkeiten.
Ah, stopp.
Start eines der modernsten Trägersysteme der Welt.
Die Ariane 5 ist ein Höhepunkt europäischer Weltraumtechnik und eine der leistungsstärksten Raketen, die jemals gebaut wurden. Der Start am 12. Juli verläuft zunächst ohne Probleme. Doch nach kurzer Zeit versagt die obere Stufe und die Rakete kommt in eine zu niedrige Umlaufbahn. Das 1-Milliarde-Euro-Projekt der ESA scheint zu scheitern. An Bord der Ariane 5 ist ein Kommunikationssatellit mit einem Clou. Ein sogenanntes Ionentriebwerk soll den Trabanten in seiner Umlaufbahn halten. Der Satellit Artemis ist auf einem Probelauf für spätere Missionen, die erstmals die Tiefen des Alls erkunden sollen. Denn dieses Triebwerk ist herkömmlichen Triebwerken weit überlegen und soll Langstreckenflüge zu fernen Planeten möglich machen.
Die Technologie ist insofern geändert, dass wir nicht mehr die chemische Reaktionsenergie zum Vortrieb nutzen, sondern ähnlich der braunschen Röhre, die wir vom Fernsehgerät her kennen, beschleunigen wir hier einen ionisierten Massenstrom. Den können wir etwa auf 10-fache Geschwindigkeit beschleunigen im Vergleich zum herkömmlichen Raketentriebwerk, also in der Größenordnung von 40.000, 50.000 Meter pro Sekunde verlässt der Strom dieses Triebwerk und erzeugt damit einen Vortrieb. Und durch die deutlich höhere Geschwindigkeit ist der Treibstoffverbrauch gesenkt.
Seit Generationen beschäftigen sich die Raketenbauer mit einem Problem, dem Treibstoffverbrauch. Gewaltige Mengen sind notwendig, um einen Flugkörper auch nur an den Rand unseres Sonnensystems zu bringen. Bis heute suchen Experten eine finanzierbare Lösung für Langstreckenflüge. Ein Vorschlag kommt aus Deutschland. SolarSail heißt das Projekt. Die einfache Idee: Satelliten mit riesigen Segeln aus Aluminium sollen durch die Sonnenwinde beschleunigt und auf Kurs gebracht werden.
Ja, die Vision vom Segeln im All ist eigentlich schon relativ alt. Geht auf 80 Jahre zurück. Da hat man sich überlegt, kann man nicht mit der Kraft der Sonne irgendwo im Weltraum rumsegeln. Der Witz ist, Sonne strahlt Photonen aus, die treffen auf das Segel auf und ganz einfach wird das Segel weggedrückt. Ganz einfach, je nach Anstellwinkel kann man sogar navigieren. Und jetzt hat man eine Technologie entwickelt, die so leicht ist und sich so klein zusammenfalten kann, dass das mit einer herkömmlichen Rakete gestartet werden kann und im Weltraum dann entfaltet werden kann.
Segeln, soweit die Sonne reicht. Und genau dies ist die Grenze von SolarSail. Fehlt die Sonne irgendwann in den Tiefen des Raums, ist Schluss mit Beschleunigung. Und eine Rückkehr gegen den Wind ist unmöglich. Anders das Ionentriebwerk von Artemis. Das handliche Aggregat bietet Beschleunigung weit über herkömmliche Grenzen hinaus. Elektrisch geladene Teilchen werden freigesetzt. Ihr Rückstoß treibt das Triebwerk voran. Kein plötzlicher, gewaltiger Schub, sondern eine konstante Beschleunigung bis weit in die Tiefen des Raums.
Die Neugierde des Menschen reicht immer aus, um seine derzeitigen Grenzen zu verlassen. Und da sind der Fantasie keine Grenzen gesetzt. Wo immer sie hinwollen, kann man eine solche Mission starten. Also was naheliegend ist, viel diskutiert, sind Mars-Missionen. Aber auch die entfernter liegenden Planeten können damit bereist werden, die Monde des Jupiter etc. Das sind die zunächst naheliegenden Ziele, aber selbstverständlich geht die Fantasie weit über das Sonnensystem hinaus.
ESA hofft, dass Artemis sich mit Hilfe seines Ionentriebwerks in die richtige Umlaufbahn bringt. Zurzeit prüft eine Untersuchungskommission den Vorfall. Am 1. August soll der Untersuchungsbericht vorliegen. Für die ESA steht viel auf dem Spiel.
Etna auf Sizilien hat sich stabilisiert. Mit Barrieren konnten die Gebäude im Bereich der Seilbahnstation in etwa 2000 Meter Höhe geschützt werden. Die gefährlichen Lavaströme, die tagelang die Station und den Ort Nicolosi bedrohten, sollen zum Stillstand gekommen sein. In der Nacht schleuderte der Vulkan erneut große Lavamassen aus einem Krater, begleitet von heftigen Explosionen und leichten Erdstößen.
Lava from Mount Etna in Sicily, Europe's most active volcano, has been erupting for more than a week. Catania Airport, at the base of the volcano, has been closed for the second time since the latest eruption began.
Rocks melted when the Earth was formed, a spat a kilometer into the skies above Mount Etna. Overnight, two new lava flows surging up between the tectonic plates that meet beneath Sicily, vented on this mountain. This eruption is by no means subsiding. Around the clock, man and nature are battling, bulldozers hefting barricades of earth to keep the lava flow from engulfing this tourist center high on Etna's shoulder. Volcanologists can't say when the danger will pass. The prediction of Earth's most primeval forces remains an imprecise science.
We can say probably something will happen, and we can say probably it will be this type of eruption. But to say with more precision than that is actually still beyond us. That's why everyone is coming here to look at Etna.
The people who live and work on the slopes of Mount Etna are genuinely afraid of these latest eruptions. No one knows better than them the devastating impact that Europe's angriest volcano can have upon their property and their lives. Peter Morgan, BBC News on Mount Etna.
Weltraumbehörde NASA bereitet in Kalifornien den Start der Raumsonde Genesis vor. Die Kapsel soll im All wie ein Staubsauger kleinste Partikel einfangen, die von der Sonne stammen. Davon erhoffen sich die Wissenschaftler neue Aufschlüsse über die Entstehung der Erde. Die Mission startet am Montag. Die Kapsel wird in 3 Jahren zurückerwartet.
Der Ätna auf Sizilien kommt nicht zur Ruhe. Nach 9 Vulkanausbrüchen musste der Flughafen der nahegelegenen Stadt Catania wieder gesperrt werden, weil Asche die Landebahn blockiert. Am Berg selbst bedroht der Lavastrom weiter ein Touristenzentrum. Helfer versuchen, die Gefahr abzuwenden. Peter Handjes.
Die ganze Nacht haben sie gekämpft. Gräben ausgehoben und Dämme aufgeschüttet, der anrückenden Glut die Stirn geboten. Am Morgen ein erstes Erfolgserlebnis. Haarscharf ist der Lavastrom an den Gebäuden vorbeigeflossen. Die Bitte um göttlichen Beistand scheint erhört. Ob die Gottesmutter auch vor der nächsten Lavawelle schützt, wird sich im Laufe des Abends zeigen. Solange die Lava fließt, ist die Gefahr nicht vorüber. Erst wenn der Vulkan nicht mehr ausbricht, können wir sagen, ob wir es geschafft haben. Während oben der Kampf weitergeht, herrscht am Fuß des Ätna ein geschäftiges Kommen und Gehen. Busweise ergießen sich Touristenströme über erkaltete Lavafelder, jeder auf der Suche nach dem Nervenkitzel und sei er auch noch so weit weg. Wenigstens ein Beweisfoto für zu Hause und schnell noch einen Lavabrocken als Souvenir. Andere sind da weniger vorsichtig. Völlig gepackt von der Faszination Vulkan riskieren sie Gesundheit und Leben, wollen der Gefahr direkt ins Auge blicken.
Es ist gewaltig, es ist phänomenal. Ich bin also begeistert von jeder Art von Vulkanismus und deswegen hast du mich auch hierher gezogen.
Abends entwickelt der Vulkantourismus dann eine besondere Dynamik. Zu Hunderten pilgern die Zuschauer zu den Magmaströmen, genießen dicht gedrängt das feurige Spektakel. Das ist eine unglaubliche Show. Ich bin zum ersten Mal hier, nur um mir dieses einmalige Schauspiel nicht entgehen zu lassen. Eine Stimmung wie bei einem nächtlichen Picknick, glühende Lava als Ersatz für Lagerfeuer und Sonnenuntergänge. An die Gefahr denkt hier niemand.
Bei der Bergung des russischen Atom-U-Bootes Kursk gibt es Probleme. Taucher sind ja in der Barentssee derzeit dabei, alles für die schwierige Bergungsaktion vorzubereiten. Doch schon gibt es Verzögerungen. Dabei soll das riesige Wrack bis Ende September eigentlich gehoben sein. 118 Menschen waren seinerzeit bei dem Untergang gestorben. Thomas Fedder berichtet.
Immer wieder gehen die Bergungstaucher in das eiskalte Wasser. 6-Stunden-Schichten rund um die Uhr, aber wo sie arbeiten, gibt es ohnehin kein Tageslicht. 100 Meter tief liegt der einstige Stolz der russischen Flotte. An Bord jede Menge geheime Militärtechnik und ein Atomreaktor. Ein hohes Risiko und es gibt noch ganz andere Probleme. Die Taucher haben nicht das passende Werkzeug. So lässt sich die spezielle Stahlhaut des Wracks kaum aufschneiden. Offenbar hat es in der internationalen Crew Abstimmungsprobleme gegeben. Wir hatten einige kleine Schwierigkeiten wie bei einer frischen Ehe. Als wir anfingen, ging es drunter und drüber. Wir sind Techniker, ein Techniker kann den anderen nicht so gut leiden. Dabei sieht in der Theorie alles so perfekt aus. Die Vorderfront mit den Torpedos soll einfach abgesägt werden. Dann wird der Rumpf mit dem Atomreaktor an Stahltrossen auf ein Spezialschiff gehievt. Nur eben diese Stahltrossen lassen sich zurzeit noch nicht befestigen. Viele Experten halten die Bergung ohnehin für ein waghalsiges Unternehmen.
Wenn beispielsweise der Bug abgesägt wird und dort eine Bombe explodiert, dann kann das eben das ganze U-Boot zerreißen. Zum anderen wissen wir auch nicht, in welchem Zustand die Reaktoren sich befinden. Auch da ist eine große Unsicherheit und ich bezweifle auch, dass die russischen Behörden hier genügend wissen.
Die Zweifel sind berechtigt. Die russische Marine hält offenbar Informationen zurück, Noch immer ist unklar, ob sich an Bord des Wracks Atomsprengköpfe befinden. Für die Taucher in der Tiefe ein schwer kalkulierbares Risiko.
Bedroht.
Die Abgasfahne reicht bereits 1000 Kilometer Richtung Sahara und die Ausbrüche des Ätna nehmen kein Ende. Im Innern hat sich viel Magma angesammelt. Europas aktivster Vulkan dampft und qualmt aus mehreren Schloten gleichzeitig. Täglich öffnen sich neue Erdspalten, bilden sich zusätzliche Krater. Weithin regnet es Asche und Bimsstein. Würde die Feuerwehr die Berggaststätte nicht immer wieder abkühlen, wäre sie längst in Flammen aufgegangen. Die hier noch rund 1000 Grad heiße Lava bedeckt und bedrängt die Berghütte bereits an zwei Seiten. Fast noch mehr Angst als die Lava machen uns die Schäden, der Verdienstausfall, die Vertragsverpflichtungen, die vor uns liegende Saison. Mit ungewohnt hoher Geschwindigkeit strömt die Lava mittlerweile talwärts. Sie wird aus mehreren Kratern und Erdspalten gespeist. Aus der Luft gleicht die Ätna-Bergbahnstation einer Insel im Lavastrom. Noch immer versuchen Zivilschutz und Armeeeinheiten fieberhaft den Ausflugsort vor dem Feuerbrei zu retten, die Lavamassen abzudrängen. Aber der Ätna legt immer mehr Lava nach, bis zu 20 Kubikmeter pro Sekunde. Eruptionen, heftige Explosionen, leichte Erdstöße, das war sein Samstagsprogramm.
A couple of years after the eruption, Mount St. Helens crater cooled. Snow stopped melting. It piled up. Two-thirds of the crater gets very little sun.
The snowpack in the rear part of the crater, in the southern part of the crater behind the dome, has reached the thickness of almost 500 feet.
John Major at the U.S. Geological Survey credits several amateur ice cave explorers with the discovery. They've brought out pictures and measurements which indicate the birth of a glacier could be in progress. In fact, there's a series of ice caves now inside the crater. But to have a glacier, you must have two things, ice and ice in motion.
So as the ice moves, there are places where the ice is in compression and places where the ice is in tension. And where it's in tension, it begins to pull apart and it forms these cracks.
Those cracks are already evident, so they have motion, but it's not truly solid ice yet.
The very lowest layers have actually turned into true ice, but the upper part of these caves and the bulk of this body of snow is essentially very dense snow.
There could be a dangerous impact from all of this. If there's even a mild eruption on Mount St. Helens, it could send 100 million cubic yards of melted ice and rock rushing downhill.
It's probably a significant risk to the upper part of the Toodle Valley.
They say sensors should give us plenty of early warning. Meanwhile, scientists watch with fascination to see if a full glacier forms in the next decade or so.
That report from Vince Patton of our affiliate KGW. NASA launched a new satellite this past week that will monitor storms both on Earth and on the Sun. The weather satellite joins several other GOES satellites in orbit, but this one includes an X-ray telescope that will look at the Sun once a minute to get early warnings of the geomagnetic storms on the Sun that can disrupt communications on Earth. At first, it will be a backup to the existing satellites, and managers haven't decided when it will start its sun-watching mission.
The next space shuttle launch at the Kennedy Space Center is Discovery, scheduled for liftoff on August 9th at 5:38 p.m. This is the 11th space shuttle mission to the International Space Station, carrying the Leonardo multipurpose logistics module. Landing occurs on August 21st at 1:17 p.m., after an 11-day, 19-hour mission. NASA's next unmanned launch is Genesis, scheduled for no earlier than August 1st at 12:32 p.m. aboard a Boeing Delta II rocket from Pad A at Space Launch Complex 17. In other space shuttle launches, Endeavour is scheduled for liftoff on November 29th at 8:05 p.m. on the 12th flight to the International Space Station with the Raffaello multipurpose logistics module. Landing occurs on December 9th. This will be the last launch for calendar year 2001. The first launch of 2002 is Space Shuttle Columbia on STS-109 on the third mission to service the Hubble Space Telescope. Launch is scheduled for January 17th at 2:40 p.m., with a landing occurring on January 28th.
Millionen Kilometer lange Reise, um die frühesten Spuren unseres Sonnensystems zu erforschen. Wenn alles gut geht, kehrt Genesis in 3 Jahren zur Erde zurück und bringt winzige Partikel mit, die ständig von der Sonne ins All geschleudert werden und aus den Sonnenwinden gefiltert werden sollen. Die Wissenschaftler sind davon überzeugt, dass diese Urmaterie auch nach mehr als 4 Milliarden Jahren noch existiert und Aufschluss darüber geben kann, wie unser Sonnensystem entstanden ist. Christoph Lang über die Reise zum Anfang des Lebens.
Unsere Sonne könnte die Antwort bereithalten auf die uralte Frage, wie ist unser Universum entstanden? Genauer gesagt, der Sonnenwind, diese Flut elektrisch geladener Teilchen, die die Sonne in die Tiefen des Alls pumpt. Einige davon soll sich diese Sonde schnappen, die hier mit allergrößter Sorgfalt montiert wird. Sie darf mit absolut nichts verunreinigt sein, sonst würden die Ergebnisse verfälscht. Sonnenmaterial zur Erde zu bringen, das ist etwas ganz Besonderes, sagt NASA-Wissenschaftler Donald Burnett. Das aufregende Projekt heißt Genesis Schöpfung, denn es ist wie eine Reise zurück in die Zeit, als das Universum entstand, so wie es diese Animation beschreibt. Der große Knall, dann die Ursuppe, aus der sich vor gut 4,5 Milliarden Jahren schließlich Planeten, Sonnen, Sonnensysteme, ganze Galaxien bildeten. Aus welchen Teilchen bestand diese Ursuppe, fragen sich die Astronomen, denn ihre Zusammensetzung würde verstehen helfen, wie die Schöpfung vor sich ging. Heute ist in unserem Sonnensystem alles erstaunlich unterschiedlich, erklärt Burnett. Aber alles begann mit einer Gassuppe, die ganz einheitlich war. Wir müssen den Anfang kennenlernen, um die Entwicklung unseres Sonnensystems verstehen zu können. Diese Antwort soll Genesis liefern, wenn sie sich im November aufspannt im All wie eine Armbanduhr, rund 1,5 Millionen Kilometer entfernt von der Erde. Die Idee dahinter ist einfach. Original-Ursuppenpartikel gibt es vermutlich an der Oberfläche der Sonne, da kommt keiner hin. Oder eben im Sonnenwind. Und dem soll sich Genesis stellen, 2,5 Jahre lang, zum wohl ausgiebigsten Sonnenbad aller Zeiten. Diese Kollektoren sind das Herzstück der Mission, gefertigt aus ultrareinen Materialien wie Gold, Diamanten oder Silikon. Sie sollen eine kostbare Ladung Sonnenwind einfangen. Nur so viel wie ein paar Körner Salz werden binnen 2,5 Jahren hängen bleiben. Fast 30 Jahre ist es her, dass Menschen zuletzt Proben aus dem All zur Erde brachten. Apollo 17, das war die letzte Mondmission. Auch hier war man übrigens dem Sonnenwind auf der Spur, mit diesen Folienfängern, primitiv im Vergleich zur heutigen Mission. Wir haben ein sehr gutes Design, lobt Burnett sein 460 Millionen Mark Projekt und exzellente Erfolgsaussichten. Bis dahin wird es aber noch dauern. Die Genesis soll mit ihrer kostbaren Minifracht erst im September 2004 zur Erde zurückkehren, mit einem raffinierten Manöver. Sie wird an Fallschirmen niedergehen und von einem Hubschrauber aufgefangen. Zunächst aber muss sie erstmal hochkommen. Der Start mittels einer Delta-Rakete wurde wegen technischer Probleme auf Mittwoch verschoben.
The Etna volcano is continuing to challenge emergency teams and amaze the tourists. Volcanic ash forced a nearby airport to close temporarily yesterday for the 3rd time in 2 weeks. John Draper reports on Etna's unpredictable path.
Once again, Mount Etna has taken the experts by surprise. More than 2 weeks after its latest eruption began, and Europe's most active volcano is still rumbling and exploding. New fissures have made redundant the scientists' predictions of its behavior. There are more streams of lava, but one day the flows slow down, the next they speed up again. The outpourings, though, are ever more spectacular. Efforts are being made to shore up the defenses of the tourist resort on the volcano, but local villages are believed to be safe.
We can say that there's no danger for the moment for the inhabited areas for Nicolosi.
The number of visitors is down, but those tourists who did make the journey got some of the best pictures of Etna they could have hoped for. They were 2 miles away picking among the lava, but some wanted to get closer.
It's too far. I want to go nearer.
But the way things are going, it might just get closer without the tourists having to move. John Draper, ITN.
Scientists at NASA will have to wait at least another day to try to launch the Genesis space probe. Thick clouds forced NASA to scrub the scheduled launch of the solar probe. The forecast for Thursday is expected to be even worse. Genesis is designed to fly close to the sun and bring back solar particles for study.
And time now for the American Edition weather forecast with Femi Okay. Hi there, Femi.
Hello, Octavia. Two big weather stories to tell you about as far as the U.S. is concerned. One is the heat across this entire area. The second one is about rainfall and tropical weather development. What you're seeing down here is known as a tropical depression. It's a cluster, as you can see, of thunderstorms and showers. In the next couple of hours, we're expecting this to actually build up into a tropical storm and then turn very quickly into a hurricane. So if you're anywhere along this Gulf Coast area into Florida area, you do need to be monitoring your local forecast, or you're heading into that area, as well as your international one. I won't be worried. Let me show you where the moisture is then, as far as that system is concerned. Heading off to the radar picture, and there you'll see a lot of rainfall across Florida, those orange and yellow areas, really heavy thunderstorms and showers, and also seeing some more showery activity just along that Gulf coastal area, and that's where we'll be keeping an eye on over the next 24 hours or so.
Spread flooding in South Florida has prompted officials to declare a state of emergency. Residents are urged to stay indoors and to avoid driving if possible. The Red Cross has set up an emergency shelter and homes have suffered flood damage. Heavy rains are the result of a tropical wave centered over the Gulf of Mexico. It's going to be hot though in the south, especially here, and we have Barry to talk about. This is a tropical storm then. Eastern Gulf of Mexico winds packing up to 72 kilometers per hour, and it's moving, as you see, parallel to the coast and closer to Louisiana. So it's too early to say if it's going to make landfall and when, but we know that it's going to track parallel to the coast, moving northwest and closer to the coast. So in the mouth of the Mississippi River is where the complicated weather is going to be.
Now, we don't have pictures of it because it's in the Gulf of Mexico, but this is the direction it's heading to. So all along this coastline, along the southeast coastline of Louisiana, there are tropical storm watches right now. Let me stand back so you can actually see the very dangerous areas, particularly if you're heading in that direction. Wind speeds right now, 40 miles an hour. This is very warm water, so it will gradually begin to pick up speed. That's what you need to fuel tropical systems, and we'll be keeping an eye on it. If you're heading in that direction, do watch this weather forecast, your world weather forecast as well, and of course the national ones and local ones for that region. Let's take a look at the rest of the weather across the U.S. Actually seeing some rain across through this southern section of the U.S. from Tennessee, stretching up through towards the northeast. I want to show it to you on the radar summary, so we'll turn it into rain. And also that's where you see a lot of the rain following that weather front, but also still seeing a tremendous amount of rain and flooding in Florida as well. Let me take you to Stuart in Florida. That's on that eastern side of Florida. Pictures from earlier on today, an amazing amount of rain. It has been pretty much raining all of this week. The kids are having a great time because it's not actually cool weather, it's actually fairly warm weather, so they're enjoying themselves. But my forecaster did say that there may potentially be alligators in that water, and on that scary note, I will leave you with your weather. It has really been a tropical special for this hour. Let's head back to Octavia at the news desk.
Thanks for me.
Well, this may be the first sign that Tropical Storm Barry is on its way. People living on the Louisiana coast are already bracing themselves and their homes for the winds Barry might throw at them. Actually, Barry isn't very strong right now, but the storm's expected to gain strength as it moves closer to land. And we can pick Barry up on our satellite. It doesn't actually look too impressive at the moment here in the Gulf of Mexico, but we do have some tropical storm watches posted for sections of southeast Louisiana, and I do think as we move through the weekend we could well see some coastal flooding across southeastern Louisiana, the coastal regions across Mississippi, Alabama, and into that western portion of the Florida Panhandle. Now, if you are following the storm, these are the latest observations we have for you. You can see Barry centered there around 300 kilometers south-southeast of the Mississippi Delta, and there the current wind speed 65 kilometers an hour. And really at the moment Barry is just drifting erratically to the west, and we don't think we'll see any strengthening, at least in the next 24 hours. But one thing guaranteed, we will keep you up to date on the very latest information.
Rainwater off the covers, protecting the balloon. The pilot, American billionaire Steve Fossett, has arrived, parking his personal jet outside a hangar normally reserved for crop spraying aircraft. The modest aerodrome is being transformed into an international mission control center. This will be Steve Fossett's sixth attempt at flying around the world. His team's confident it's learnt from its mistakes.
All the designs, the testing, the team we've got is, I feel, the very best there is. And so it's kind of like when everything's perfect, then it's goofs up, then that makes you kind of step back for a second and figure out where did we go wrong.
Steve Fossett's last solo attempt was less than 2 months ago. It ended before even getting off the ground. High winds tore the seams of the balloon before it was fully inflated. Such was the disappointment, Steve Fossett declared his record ballooning days were over, but he simply can't resist another go.
It's a marvelous experience to be flying in a balloon, to fly across the continent of Australia, to fly across an ocean. I often look outside and just marvel at what is going on, that I am actually way out there over an ocean.
This is the capsule in which he'll live. At more than 20,000 feet up, he'll have to climb out to change gas bottles each time they run out. This cockpit is also prepared for the worst. Most of the journey will be over water. If it does ditch into the ocean, it's designed to become a personal lifeboat, bobbing around in the sea until it's found by rescuers. But if all goes to plan, the balloon should be landing back in Australia in about 2 weeks' time. Michael Peshard, BBC News, Northern Western Australia.
Now, the oldest member of Britain's royal family, the Queen Mother, is celebrating her 101st birthday. She was joined by other members of the royal family after being greeted by thousands of well-wishers outside her home in central London. Just 2 days ago, the Queen Mother was admitted to hospital suffering from anemia. Her grandson and the heir to the throne, Prince Charles, has also taken part in the celebrations. He's also just been released from hospital after falling from a horse during a polo match on Friday. That's it from us for now.
Prinz Charles hat das Krankenhaus nach seinem Sturz beim Polospiel wieder verlassen, genau rechtzeitig, um heute den 101. Geburtstag seiner Großmutter, Queen Mum, mitfeiern zu können. Die alte Dame war selber auch erst gestern aus dem Krankenhaus entlassen worden. Aus London, Pamela Schlatterer.
101 Jahre hat sie durchgehalten, das soll ihr erst mal einer nachmachen. Queen Mum, die blaublütige, zähe Urgroßmutter, sie ist ein wahrer Dauerbrenner der Briten. Tausende drängelten sich heute, um der alten Dame zu gratulieren und können sich ein Leben ohne Queen Mum einfach nicht vorstellen. Unsere Monarchie wäre ohne Queen Mum nicht mehr das, was sie mal war, sagt dieser Fan. Er kampierte zusammen mit ein paar ganz hartgesottenen schon seit gestern, um den besten Platz zu ergattern. Belohnt wurde das mit der besten Sicht auf Queen Mums Omi-Buggy, mit dem sie an ihren Fans vorbeirattert und Geschenke einsammelt. Dieses haarige Etwas da vorne auf Stummelbeinen ist übrigens Queen Mums Lieblingshund, ein Corgi. Einmal nur kam sie kurz ins Straucheln, lehnte den angebotenen Stuhl aber eisern ab. Ihr Enkel Charles hätte ihn wahrscheinlich gerne genommen, fiel er doch gestern beim Polospielen so hart vom Pferd, dass er erst einmal leblos flach lag. Ich lebe noch, rief er heute charmant den Journalisten zu, als er das Krankenhaus verließ. Und so war er heute natürlich bei der Familienfeier dabei. Schließlich hat der junge Hüpfer Charles auch erst 52 Mal mit seiner Großmutter Geburtstag gefeiert.
A 101, and as determined as ever, the Queen Mother defied both her age and her recent ill health to take the salute as the band of the Grenadier Guards played Happy Birthday. Some 7,000 people joined in the celebrations, which had seemed in doubt for a time on Wednesday when the Queen Mother was admitted to hospital. There was an uneasy moment when she briefly lost her balance and fell back onto the chair that had been brought out in the hope she'd use it. She quickly stood up again, but looked shocked. She'd been given the go-ahead for the festivities by her doctor last night and stubbornly remained standing as dozens of children were ushered forward with their cards and flowers. It was only after about a quarter of an hour on her feet that she finally took to her electric buggy to tour the lines of well-wishers. She told them she was feeling much better and thanked them for their gifts.
Very touching. Thank you, Anna. Cheers.
She just looks so well, especially after everything she's been through. I was just really impressed. She just looked so good.
And Prince Charles, who arrived with both his sons, looked well too, in spite of his heavy fall at polo yesterday and a night in hospital. But it was clear that Princess Margaret, making a rare appearance in public, is still suffering the effects of a series of strokes. With her left arm and leg virtually paralyzed and her eyesight impaired, she had to be encouraged to wave to the crowds. In Hyde Park, meanwhile, another birthday tribute for the Queen Mother. a 41-gun salute from the King's Troop Royal Horse Artillery. By then, all the family had gathered at Clarence House, four generations of royalty led by a woman whose indomitable spirit has seen her through another busy year.
This was a steely performance by any standards from a woman who simply refuses to give in to her age. And as if to underline that, the Queen Mother's planning to fly to her remote castle on the coast of Caithness in 3 days' time.
The wave is a little shakier now. At 101 years old, Britain's beloved Queen Mother navigates cautiously. Still, the Queen Mum managed this public appearance less than 3 days after being released from hospital, where she received blood transfusions for anemia. This weekend is the birthday of the Queen Mother, mother to Britain's Queen Elizabeth II. At Clarence House, her official residence, the crowd sang "Happy Birthday" to perhaps the most beloved member of Britain's royal family. Scores of children pressed bouquets upon her. At one point, the Queen Mother appeared to stumble ever so slightly, but she recovered quickly. A buggy, the Royal Golf Cart, was pressed into service for a 40-minute tour with everyone from ladies-in-waiting to the Queen Mum's devoted corgi. The dog seemed to enjoy the romp even more than its mistress. There were the family photos to be taken. Here the Queen Mother with her younger daughter, Princess Margaret, in a wheelchair, the princess having suffered several strokes. Then this family portrait with Queen Elizabeth II and the Queen Mum and the family. Prince Charles was there. He too was just released from hospital, took a nasty fall from his polo pony and was knocked unconscious. Earlier he was asked about his mishap.
How are you, sir?
Prince Charles replied hoarsely, "I'm all right." But this day belonged to his grandmother. One royals watcher summed up the Queen Mother's popularity.
She's built into the fabric of our society. As you know, she was born with the beginning of the last century. So I don't think there is an English person who can't remember the Queen Mother always having been there.
Congratulations and celebrations. We want the world to know that you are 101.
Remembering and celebrating is what this day was about. Walter Rogers, CNN, London.
What can we say but happy birthday? That's world news for now. I'm Jim Clancy. For Femi and me and the entire CNN team on duty around the world this day, Mike Hanna in the Middle East, Charlene Hunter-Galt in South Africa, Jill Doherty in Moscow, Walter Rogers in London, and of course, all of the producers, editors, writers, and technical staff here at CNN Center. Thanks for spending a part of your day with us.
Make it sixth time lucky as he attempts to fly solo around the world in a balloon. The journey, if successful, should take around 15 days. He's planning to take off from the small town of Northam in Western Australia later this evening. Our reporter Michael Peschart is there.
Early today, all seemed to be going perfectly to plan. The weather fine, the pilot enthusiastic about his sixth attempt at flying around the world.
It's a marvelous experience to be flying in a balloon, to fly across the continent of Australia, to fly across an ocean.
But as a bitterly cold outback night wore on, yet more delays. The wind was either too strong or in the wrong direction. Steve Fawcett and his team could do nothing but wait. They've already spent more than a week hanging on for the right weather.
They've not even been able to inflate the balloon yet. This adventure was never going to be easy, but few thought the takeoff would prove quite so tricky. Michael Peschart, BBC News, Northam, Western Australia.
It left more than a foot of rain in Florida. Dozens of homes were flooded in the worst-hit area of Mountain County on the East Coast. It even affected NASA. The launch of its Genesis craft from Cape Canaveral to capture tiny pieces of the sun was postponed yesterday because of the weather. Now, Tropical Storm Barry is threatening the Louisiana coast of North America. Authorities warn, although it isn't a hurricane, the tropical storm can still cause damage.
We don't want people to let their guard down. In fact, we can remember Tropical Storm Allison, not a very strong system either, and we had a tremendous amount of rain. Barry is also primarily a rainfall threat right now.
Recent reports say the storm is hovering in the Gulf of Mexico, and it could hit the Louisiana coastline on Sunday night.
After making his mark on Florida, Tropical Storm Barry is now flirting with Louisiana and keeping forecasters guessing. Tourists and campers have been asked to leave Grand Isle State Park, about 55 miles from New Orleans, where a tropical storm warning is now in effect. The Texaco and Chevron corporations have evacuated non-essential personnel from oil platforms off the coast of Louisiana. For the latest on Barry's strength and its potential path, Brad Huffines joins us now. He's actually at the weather map right next to us. Brad, those oil platforms are built for this, so this is a significant development.
Yeah, Stephen, they are built for heavy winds, but it just shows that they're being cautious, taking the precautions because this storm, which so far has been, I'm not going to say unpredictable, I'm going to say erratic, because of the fact the storm has been drifting to the west, and it now is moving to the north very slowly. In fact, the latest Hurricane Center advisory shows that it's moving north at somewhere close to 1 mile an hour. So the storm is just not showing much motion at all. It's just off the coast of Mobile, Alabama, actually some 150 miles or so off the shoreline. Let me show you what a tropical storm warning means, and I'll tell you where we have one. Tropical storm warnings mean that tropical storm force winds expected in the area between 24 and 36 hours. And right now we have tropical storm warnings from Grand Isle, Louisiana, to the mouth of the Pearl River near Apalachicola, Florida. That means in that bank, that block of coastline between Grand Isle and Apalachicola, that's where we expect the landfall of Tropical Storm Barry with winds of at least 35 knots or 40 miles an hour. It looks as if right now Barry should hit land sometime on early Monday morning with winds of somewhere close to 60 to 70 miles an hour. So a very strong tropical storm, or what could be a very weak hurricane, hitting the shoreline again somewhere around Pensacola. The highest strike probabilities are Pensacola, Florida. Let me explain one more time, Stephen. The heaviest threat of rains and wind are to the right of where the storm hits. So wherever the storm hits, from that point to the right, or in this case to the east, that's where we expect the heaviest winds and rain, from Pensacola, Florida to Apalachicola, if the storm does, in fact, continue to move north and hit landfall around Pensacola, Florida. So, Stephen, that's the best forecast right now. I hate to use the word guess, but in some cases, Stephen, that's about what it is.
The city's Emergency Preparedness Center is up and monitoring Barry's path. Where it hits is a best-guess scenario, but New Orleans doesn't want to get caught off guard.
With all the technology and everything, it is possible for us to really be ready. It is possible for us to save lives by what we know.
Some buildings are sandbagging, while tugs and other ships head inland. But if Barry doesn't pick up strength and steam, many don't expect the storm will dampen daily celebrations in the French Quarter. Sean Calebs, CNN, New Orleans.
Federal emergency officials are now in southeastern Florida, where Tropical Storm Barry made a call earlier in the week. FEMA is there to take a look at the damage and decide what assistance Floridians may need. Rising water and heavy rain flooded scores of homes Friday in Martin County, which is now under an emergency declaration. On the upside there, no reports of injuries or deaths.
Tropical Storm Barry had been moving west. Now, as we talked about earlier, starting to drift to the north. Latest coordinates on Barry put the storm at 27.2 north, 87.5 west. Winds are still at 40, pressure 1,005. Not that strong, however, should intensify as it moves north. Latest Hurricane Center projections puts landfall around Pensacola, Florida, which means that areas from Pensacola to the right or to the east will expect the heaviest winds, rains, and seas. Areas to the left will decrease fairly rapidly. So again, it's really critical where you are in relation to the center of the storm. So we'll watch this very carefully and have more updates through the evening as well.
Some highly educated guesses. That is the case with Tropical Storm Barry this hour churning over the Gulf of Mexico. Some people are boarding up their waterfront homes now. Saturday, tourists and campers on Grand Isle, Louisiana, were asked to leave the area. The National Hurricane Center has posted a tropical storm warning now for the Mississippi River Delta region, extending from Grand Isle to the mouth of the Pearl River, including New Orleans. Let's go straight to one affected area, Gulfport, Mississippi, and reporter Robert Arnold with CNN affiliate KPRC-TV. Robert, you're based in Houston. Why are you chasing this as far as Gulfport?
One of the predictabilities, or pardon me, one of the difficult things about this storm has been its unpredictability. again, when Barry first started churning in the Gulf, there was the possibility it could come into the Galveston-Houston area. Well, again, that has changed. Even today, the day began with Barry predicted to go into the New Orleans area. As the day went on, the prediction shifted to this area, Gulfport-Biloxi. Now, even late predictions are saying Barry could go off into Mobile, Alabama, possibly as far as Pensacola. What has been difficult for residents along this entire stretch is they're not exactly sure what they should do. Should they start boarding up their homes further inland? Should they begin stocking up on supplies such as water and food? But again, it's a waiting game until Barry decides on more of a course. And we are starting to see a few drops of rain out here, but again, nothing severe. The winds have not even picked up in this area very much as well. We also have several tourists who've been out here all day sunning themselves. And again, they're just going to wait for tomorrow and hopefully get a better understanding of exactly where Barry may go. Stephen?
Robert Arnold reporting to us from what looks to be a very calm and peaceful Gulfport, Mississippi. Robert, thank you very much. Of course, that poses the very dilemma for residents along the coast, what to do when a storm is stalled and isn't making it clear where it's headed next. Let's turn to Brad Huffines for some sense of what people are reading in this at the latest at this hour.
It's one of these tough things, Stephen, where folks who want to know what to do, right now the storm isn't giving us enough indication yet. All we can say to you is just be ready to act and move when you need to move. When evacuation notices are issued, be ready to evacuate. Right now we're showing you the satellite and radar, and you can tell very clearly the clouds are not really moving at any breakneck speed anywhere. You're seeing the clouds continuing to rotate around the center of the storm, which is very ill-defined right now. The mouth of the center of the storm is 165 miles southeast of the mouth of the Mississippi River and is continuing to rotate very slowly, still stationary. This storm has not yet shown its hand and shown us exactly where it's going to drift next. I want to show you why that is in just a moment. First, the latest coordinates showing it nearly stationary. Winds are still at 40 miles an hour, but as we all know, with the warm waters of the Gulf, once this begins to move off center and move any direction it's going to move, right now the forecast is north toward Pensacola, Florida. The storm will, and it is in fact expected to strengthen as it does move north. You can tell in the satellite picture these are the enhanced clouds. The higher the clouds, the redder the color. You can tell the storm center is not really quite well defined yet. A hurricane center reconnaissance plane is scheduled to approach the center of the storm within the hour. This is why the storm is just not moving much. The jet stream flow is showing fairly nondescript winds in the Gulf of Mexico. With the winds aloft very weak, it's just not able to push the storm anywhere, and much like a top on a tabletop, it's not going anywhere. And you can see the heat index values to the west of the storm very hot because the clouds have not yet spread west to at least give any relief to the heat where we have still had heat advisories.
Despite delays due to high winds, the Fawcett team says the launch was perfect. If conditions stay favorable, it's hoped the balloon will fly eastwards across Australia, over the South Pacific, South America, and the Southern Atlantic, then just south of Cape Town and across the Indian Ocean to land back in Western Australia. During the journey, which will take about 15 days, the balloon will be carried by jet stream winds at speeds of over 200 kilometers an hour.
In the end, they decided they could wait no longer. The poor weather that's been frustrating this mission for more than a week, evident as they began inflating the balloon. Rainwater collected in the canopy, drenching the support crew. It was still too windy as well, but this was always going to be a venture fraught with risk.
It'd be nice if everything were perfect and we could be assured that it would work, but that's not the circumstance. And so we will have to take the calculated risk.
As dawn began to break, another weather obstacle. Fog was obscuring parts of the 160-foot-high balloon.
Steve Fawcett is not a man easily put off. After a very long wait, everything seems okay for takeoff. This is his sixth attempt at flying around the world. He's hoping the journey will take him 15 days.
Several hundred well-wishers had stayed up all night to see him off. They cheered as the balloon eventually began to lift. It was a perfect takeoff. Steve Fawcett knows the dangers that lie ahead, but his support crew says his spirits are high.
They are, really. I mean, he loves to fly. And so when he's up and going, that's the happiest he can be.
Most of the journey will be over water. The first 2 days crossing Australia are vital for testing equipment before venturing out over the Pacific. Michael Peshart, BBC News, Northam, Western Australia.
This was the scene as Chicago tycoon Steve Fawcett lifted off about 1 hour ago, making a renewed attempt to circle the Earth by hot air balloon. Fawcett lifted off from Northam, Australia, just as the Sunday morning sun was rising. The balloon actually got a lot of helium in it, not just hot air. This is his fifth attempt at solo flight, a trip experts say should take about 15 days. So far, though, no unaccompanied pilot has been able to complete that journey.
Well, our correspondent Michael Pashard witnessed the launch in Northam, and he joins us now. Michael, the team was soaked and jubilant, but are they confident?
Well, I think so. I mean, they are, though, very aware of the risks. I mean, they've been together with Steve Fawcett for many years. As you heard there, this is his sixth attempt, and none of them have been successful to date. So they're very aware of the dangers, but they do feel that they have the best chance today, and the takeoff was perfect this morning.
But he's still going to be at the mercy of the winds, isn't he? And he's going to be living in very cramped conditions for 15 days, hopefully.
Yeah, it's not going to be the most comfortable way to travel around the world. I suppose that the capsule that he's in is about sort of 8 foot long and about 3 foot wide. There's barely enough room for him to move inside. He'll have to eat living sort of army rations with chemically heated foodstuffs over the next 2 weeks or so. And they reckon that he'll only be able to have about 4 hours sleep a day, and he won't be able to sleep for more than 45 minutes at a time, because he's got to continually check the altitude so that he can be in the best possible place to pick up the jet stream wind so that he can get around the world as quickly as possible and also end up more or less where he wants to in Australia.
It certainly sounds that if you've got to suffer for your world record, but what about communications? Is he going to be in touch with his team on the ground the whole time?
Yes, he does have a very, very good communication system, and they have something like four backup systems if anything goes wrong. He's got emails, he's got radios, he's got GPS navigators. He's also got a lot of safety equipment on board. Most of the journey will be over water, and of course the danger is that he may have to ditch out in the sea at some stage, and that really would be very, very difficult to find him. So they want to be sure that they can locate him at all times. The cockpit itself has been designed so that it will turn into a personal life raft. It will float on the water. Hopefully then the navigation beacons, if the worst comes to the worst, hopefully the navigation beacons will then alert rescuers and he will be found.
He is a very wealthy man, but these expeditions and adventures are very expensive. If he doesn't succeed this time, and I hope he does, will he try a seventh time, do you think?
Now, that's a very good question, and when I asked him actually only yesterday, he said, judging by my record so far, very probably I will try again.
So, but what will happen to the balloon? If he comes down, he'll have to start from scratch, supposedly, because you can't, I don't suppose you could salvage all that equipment.
Well, no, you're quite right. I mean, it is a hugely expensive undertaking. There's something like 20 people here. There's also a mission control center in the United States. He's got his personal jet, which he flew in, and which is now sort of gone off, actually, to fly around him just to check that the balloon is okay. He brought out the balloon manufacturers and designers from the UK to last month after there was an accident when he tried to launch in Kalgoorlie less than 2 months ago. He decided rather than take the balloon back to the factory, he'd bring the factory to the balloon. So you get an idea of the huge scale, the amount of money that he's spending on this. He's very, very determined, and it seems that money's no object in pursuit of a world record.
That's a very good thing. We'll be watching him every inch of the way. Michael Pashard in Northam in Western Australia. Thanks.
Noch immer spuckt der Asche. Noch immer grummelt es im Koloss von Sizilien. Doch die Behörden haben Entwarnung gegeben. Die Situation sei unter Kontrolle, heißt es aus dem Lagezentrum am Fuß des Ätna. Ab sofort dürfen Touristen wieder auf den Vulkan steigen. Allerdings nur bis zur halben Höhe. Noch vor Tagen war das Ausflugszentrum Refugio Sapienza von der glühenden Lava bedroht. Jetzt ist die Masse kurz vor den ersten Häusern zum Erliegen gekommen. Eine Fügung, die den Tourismusverband gleich auf eine neue Idee gebracht hat. Als Attraktion für sensationslüsterne und naturschauspielbegeisterte Ausflügler werden nun Führungen zu den Eruptionsgebieten des größten Vulkans Europas angeboten. Ein Shuttlebus soll die Teilnehmer zur Südstation des Ätna in rund 1900 Metern Höhe bringen. Von dort geht es dann in einer etwa einstündigen Besichtigungstour unter fachkundiger Anweisung in die erkaltete Lava. Nach 2 Wochen hat sich die Lage rund um den Vulkan merklich entspannt, obwohl er noch immer großzügig Asche über die gesamte Region verteilt. Bei dem schwersten Ausbruch des Ätna seit Jahrzehnten gab der Berg immer wieder gigantische Magma und gewaltige Gesteinslawinen frei. Der Sachschaden geht in die Millionen. Menschen wurden jedoch nicht verletzt. Fawcett zur Erdumrundung gestartet. Der amerikanische Millionär stieg mit seinem Ballon zu einem erneuten Versuch einer Weltumrundung in Australien auf. Ein letzter Startversuch im Juli war aufgrund widriger Winde gescheitert. Im August 1998 hätte es Fawcett fast geschafft, als erster die Erde allein im Ballon zu umrunden.
During the second day of his visit to Moscow, he viewed Russia's space program. On Saturday, he signed a joint declaration with President Putin, stating that Pyongyang's missile program is no threat to countries which respect North Korean sovereignty. The Russians say Mr. Kim pledged to stick to a moratorium on missile launches until 2003 and declared that North Korea's missile program was peaceful. It has taken off from Western Australia on his sixth attempt to fly solo around the world in a balloon. Despite delays due to high winds, the Fawcett team says the launch was perfect. That's it.
Abenteurer Steve Fawcett ist in Australien erneut mit einem Heißluftballon gestartet, um darin als erster Mensch allein die Welt zu umrunden. In mehreren tausend Metern Höhe will sich Fawcett mit etwa 200 Kilometer pro Stunde treiben lassen. 15 bis 18 Tage soll die Ballonfahrt dauern. Die ersten 24 Stunden bezeichnete Fawcett als die kritischste Phase. Der 57-Jährige hat bereits mehrere Versuche hinter sich. Der letzte scheiterte im Juni.
Steve Fawcett is now flying across the Australian continent. At about 20,000 feet up over the outback, he's attempting to sort out problems with his communications equipment inside his tiny cockpit. It needs to be right before venturing out over the Pacific Ocean.
My main mode of communications is satellite email, and it seems to be an antenna problem. I'm working on changing antenna components now.
He very nearly failed to take off at all. Throughout the night, they'd battled to inflate the balloon. The rainwater collected in the canopy, an indication of the appalling weather that delayed this flight for more than a week. But first light brought a transformation. Dead calm conditions. So still, the balloon was shrouded in early morning mist.
Steve Fawcett is not a man easily put off. After a very long wait, everything seems okay for takeoff. This is his sixth attempt at flying around the world. He's hoping the journey will take him 15 days.
Hundreds of well-wishers cheered as Solo Spirit eventually left the ground. Despite the problems, his support crew say the American billionaire adventurer is in good spirits.
They are, really. I mean, he loves to fly. And so when he's up and going, that's the happiest he can be.
He's been having to climb out of his cockpit to do the repairs. The capsule has been designed to operate as a personal life raft, should he have to ditch into the sea at any time. Michael Peschart, BBC News, Northern Western Australia.
Fawcett took off from the Western Australian desert on Sunday. He's now floating towards Brisbane and the Pacific. Mark Gibson has more.
The moment Steve Fawcett was beginning to think might never arrive. Liftoff into an exhilarating world fraught with danger. Northam provided a breathtaking backdrop. The Avon Valley fog, the sun heralding a historic day, the balloon floating skyward like a giant silver cone. Minutes later, drama. With the balloon plunging back towards Earth, 7 News can show you cabin cam. Pilot Steve Fawcett frantically throwing sand overboard to reduce the cabin's weight. The balloon regains its upward momentum, but Fawcett radios he's having major communication trouble.
The MRSAT-C is failing to log in. Right now I plan to retry all the plugs, just take them out and put them back in.
Here you can see the 57-year-old put on an oxygen mask and daringly lean outside the capsule trying to fix the problem. A shaky start, but this lifetime adventurer remains positive. Tonight, the 57-year-old American is flying 10 kilometres above Central Australia. He expects to cross the east coast near Brisbane tomorrow lunchtime before circling the globe, returning to WA in just over 2 weeks. That's if all goes to plan. 3 years ago, Fawcett was lucky to survive after hitting a fierce storm and ditching in the Coral Sea. Last night, a huge crowd waited patiently as tricky winds again delayed the balloon's inflation. At 2:30 a.m., Fawcett decided to gamble.
We've decided we're going to take the risk and try to launch this balloon.
So on his sixth attempt, Steve Fawcett is finally flying his way into the record books. If the stunning start is anything to go by, the billionaire balloonist is in for one hell of a ride. Mark Gibson, 7 News.
Bring down on the US Gulf Coast, and residents are preparing for the worst. The storm is getting faster and stronger as it approaches land, and experts say Barry could be upgraded to a hurricane. If the storm stays on its present path, forecasters think it will strike land on Monday, somewhere between Mobile, Alabama, and Pensacola, Florida. Doing a little sightseeing in Russia, a day after a summit with Russian President Vladimir Putin. Mr. Kim toured the Russian Space Center just outside Moscow, where we saw a replica of the Mir space station and inspected Russian rockets. Saturday was a more formal day for Mr. Kim. He and Mr. Putin issued a declaration renewing strategic ties between the two countries and criticizing U.S. plans to develop a missile defense system. Kim traveled across Russia on a 9-day train trip to attend the meeting on the 100th anniversary of the Trans-Siberian Railway.
I'm glad that you have finally arrived after such a journey. You have done just what your father did when he came to Moscow.
The weather. It's over to Lola in the International Weather Forecast Center. Hello, Lola.
Hello, John. And yes, top story continues to be Barry, who is still leaving some rain in the picture. Gusty winds across the Gulf Coast. Now, it is southwest of the Florida Panhandle, and we are expecting during today, continuing on tomorrow, more showers, scattered thunderstorms throughout all this area, Alabama, Mississippi, going into the Carolinas. There's a thunderstorm also warning in effect between Grand Isle, Louisiana, going into the Apalachicola, Florida. Now, coastal flooding is expected around this area. We do advise caution for those of you that may be traveling in the area, moving northward, and it could see landfall towards late hours of Sunday, moving into early Monday. Now,
tell us what's going on.
Well, Barry has strengthened quite significantly this morning. It's very close to being a hurricane right now, and we expect that by the time it makes landfall, it will be a hurricane.
What are the differences between the tropical storm and the hurricane, and what would be that impact on residents along the Gulf Coast?
Well, the difference between a tropical storm and a hurricane mainly is with a Category 1 hurricane, and that's what we think we're going to have, you'll have a little bit higher storm surge, so 4 to 5 feet of storm surge. The main threat is to marine interests still, boats out there. Heavy rainfall, we're expecting 8 to 10 inches of rain with some isolated amounts, possibly more than that, and a few tornadoes. All that goes along with a strong tropical storm or a weak hurricane.
And where do you now expect that potential hurricane to hit the coast? What specific point are you now guessing it will occur?
Well, we're looking at the western Florida Panhandle, somewhere west of Panama City. The storm right now is south of Fort Walton Beach. It could be someplace close to there, but anywhere in that western Florida Panhandle.
And when do you think that might happen?
Well, right now it looks like early Monday morning sometime. The tropical storm force winds will be getting to the coast during the evening this evening, and then the weather will deteriorate from there.
James Franklin of the National Hurricane Center in Miami, thank you so much for joining us. And of course, CNN will continue its coverage of this potentially developing hurricane.
Sturm Barry rast auf die Küste Floridas zu. Die Bewohner rechnen damit, dass in den nächsten Stunden das Festland erreicht. Mit einer Windgeschwindigkeit von 113 Stundenkilometern hat der Sturm beinahe die Stärke eines Hurrikans. Meteorologen warnen vor heftigem Regen, der die betroffenen Gebiete überfluten könnte.
Ohne die Sonne wäre Leben auf der Erde nicht möglich. Sie ist der Ursprung, aber wahrscheinlich auch das Ende allen Lebens. Denn die Sonne wächst und wird dabei immer heißer. Irgendwann wird die Erde deshalb verglühen. Doch es gibt einen Astronomen, der schon jetzt Vorkehrungen dafür getroffen hat.
Die Sonne und ihr Inneres. Ein gewaltiges Kraftwerk. Wasserstoff verschmilzt zu Helium. Das Helium sammelt sich im Zentrum und verändert langsam die Struktur der Sonne. Die Sonne scheint immer heller und wird immer heißer. In etwa 5 Milliarden Jahren ist ihre Energie aufgebraucht. Dann bläht sie sich auf zu einem gigantischen Feuerball, einem roten Riesen. Doch schon lange vorher, in etwa 1 Milliarde Jahren, könnte die immer heißer werdende Sonne der Erde gefährlich werden. Denn die Hitze verdampft Ozeane. Die Erde würde austrocknen. Übrig bliebe ein toter Planet mit ähnlichen Bedingungen wie auf der Venus. Trockenheit, Hitze, das Ende allen Lebens. Ein Sonnenaufgang, so wie er in 5 Milliarden Jahren aussähe, hier wäre früher die Stadt New York gewesen. Aber wen kümmert schon der Untergang der Erde in Milliarden von Jahren? Ihn, Don Korychansky. Der amerikanische Astronom will die Erde retten. Sein Plan ist einfach.
Um die Erde zu retten, müssen wir den Radius ihrer Umlaufbahn vergrößern. Das heißt, wenn die Sonne also immer heißer wird und damit auch die Erde heißer wird, müssen wir die Erde einfach von der Sonne wegbewegen. So bleiben die Temperaturen konstant. Das Leben auf der Erde kann weitergehen.
Aha, die Erde bewegen. Nichts leichter als das. Und wie? Don Korychansky hat lange gesucht, bis er auf die Lösung kam. Ein Asteroid soll die Erde aus der Bahn werfen.
Der Asteroid müsste nah an der Erde vorbeifliegen, in einer Distanz von etwa 16.000 Kilometern. Wenn er vorbeifliegt, wirken sowohl die Gravitationskräfte der Erde als auch die des Asteroiden. Das heißt, beide Körper ziehen sich gegenseitig an. So können wir die Erde in ihrer Umlaufbahn nach vorne ziehen und den Abstand zur Sonne ein klein wenig vergrößern. Jedes Mal um etwa 50 Kilometer.
Die Anziehungskraft der Erde würde die Flugbahn des Asteroiden verändern. Gleichzeitig würde auch der Asteroid eine Anziehungskraft ausüben und bei seinem ellipsenartigen Flug die Erde ein Stück mitreißen. So würde die Erde sich von der Sonne wegbewegen.
Wir müssen das sehr oft wiederholen, denn jede Begegnung mit einem Asteroiden bewegt die Erde nur ein kleines Stück. Das ist auch gut so. Die Sonne erwärmt sich ja auch nur langsam. Würden wir die Erde mit einem Mal zu weit wegbewegen, würde sie einfrieren. Und das wollen wir nicht.
Alle 6000 Jahre will Don Korychansky einen Asteroiden aus dem All Richtung Erde schicken. Bleibt nur ein Problem. Wie bringt man ihn dazu, an der Erde vorbeizufliegen?
Ein Asteroid, der sich auf einer Umlaufbahn um die Sonne bewegt, bleibt immer im gleichen Abstand zur Sonne, weil er sich bewegt. Wenn man ihn aber abbremst, wird er einfach in Richtung Sonne fallen, wegen der Gravitation. Wir müssen also den Asteroiden abbremsen. Dann fällt er in die Mitte unseres Sonnensystems und passiert dabei die Erde.
Ein bemanntes Raumschiff müsste also zu dem Asteroiden fliegen und eine Art Raketendüse anbringen, die den Himmelskörper abbremst. Von der Gravitation der Sonne angezogen, würde der Asteroid dann wie ein Stein Richtung Sonne und damit auch Richtung Erde fallen. Nur wie hinkommen? Eine Reise würde knapp 15 Jahre dauern, denn die geeigneten Asteroiden sind weiter von der Erde entfernt als der Planet Pluto. Mehr als 6 Milliarden Kilometer. Für Don Korychansky allerdings kein Problem. Es ist ja auch nicht sein Problem.
Das ist ein Problem, das die Ingenieure in der Zukunft lösen müssen. Uns wird es vielleicht in ein paar hundert oder tausend Jahren möglich sein, wenn wir weiter technische Fortschritte machen.
if we continue to develop our technology and our space programs.
Auch wenn die Erde nicht selbst retten kann, Don Korychansky hat zumindest frühzeitig den Grundstein dazu gelegt. Die Ingenieure haben jetzt genügend Zeit, daran zu arbeiten. Die nächsten Millionen oder Milliarden Jahre.
Ob dieser Plan je durchgeführt wird, ist allerdings mehr als fraglich, denn ob es in 3 bis 5 Milliarden Jahren auf der Erde überhaupt noch Menschen gibt, ist eher unwahrscheinlich.
Storm known as Barry is starting to break up as it moves over Alabama. Barry has been downgraded from a tropical storm to a tropical depression. Meteorologists say their main concern now is flooding and possible tornadoes. Barry came ashore earlier in the Florida Panhandle with winds nearing 104 kilometers per hour. At its height, it left more than 37,000 people in Florida without electricity. So to find out exactly where that storm is heading and what it's looking like right now, let's join Jenny Harrison at the Weather Center. Jenny.
Jimmy, hi. Yes, well, you can see on this radar image, which in fact we've just been looking at, this is the whole area which is now encompassed by what is now Tropical Depression Barry. In fact, the winds are down to about 29 miles an hour. Obviously gusting stronger than that to perhaps around 50 or 60 miles an hour. It's moving quite fast still at about 13 miles an hour. That, of course, is always a good sign with these systems, because the faster they move, the less time they have to deposit the rainfall. Already we've had as much as 10 inches of rain across the Florida Panhandle, and we're going to be expecting to see similar amounts of rainfall as this system actually moves further towards the north. Now, I can give you a slightly different view of this system as well. In fact, we're looking first of all at Europe, but then as we head around across the Atlantic, you can begin to see really the size of this storm we're talking about. All of this cloud here, all of this is part and parcel of that depression. But I'll have more on the forecast coming up a little bit later in the program. But for now, back to you, Toomey.
Jenny, thank you.
Absolutely, Toomey. A little bit of everything, really. Or perhaps a little bit too much rain is perhaps the definite one here. Now, this is just a reminder of the radar I showed you a few moments ago. You can see this is now a tropical depression. What was the tropical storm Barry? It's now been downgraded to a tropical depression. Elsewhere, across really every other state, not a great deal of rain. Instead, as you certainly mentioned a moment ago, there will continue to be some pretty high temperatures. Now, there's a reminder again of at the end of that sequence showing a huge mass of cloud. This is all again tied to that tropical depression. So as we head off into Monday afternoon, Barry will continue to move in a north-northwesterly direction, actually moving fairly quickly at about 13 or 15 miles an hour. But in fact, as it continues to move further to the north, so we'll see a fair amount of rain with that system, particularly into Alabama, Mississippi, across into Georgia, Tennessee, and also across into Kentucky as well. Thunderstorms will be likely with the system. Also, there will be some isolated tornadoes, and generally very warm with extremely high humidities, you might expect.
Für viele Amerikaner ist es die bittere Seite des Sommers. Tropische Hitze und hohe Luftfeuchtigkeit bringen jedes Jahr auch Wirbelstürme mit sich. Schon im Juni hatte Allison vor allem in Texas und Louisiana schwere Verwüstungen angerichtet. Jetzt macht Tropensturm Barry den Menschen in Florida große Sorgen.
Mit einer Geschwindigkeit von 110 Kilometern pro Stunde war Barry über den Golf von Mexiko gerast. In den frühen Morgenstunden erreichte der tropische Sturm Florida. Etwas abgeschwächt, aber extrem feucht. Zahlreiche Straßen, auch im Hinterland, sind überflutet. Flughäfen wurden gesperrt. In manchen Teilen fielen bis zu 30 Zentimeter Regen. Floridas Gouverneur Jeb Bush hatte die Bevölkerung schon vorher aufgefordert, die Evakuierungswarnungen zu beachten. Doch die Massenflucht blieb aus. Einige Häuser am Strand wurden vorsichtshalber verbarrikadiert. Besonders gefährdet waren auch die zahlreichen Wohnwagen. Dutzende von Touristen jedoch wollten sich den Strandtag nicht vermiesen lassen. Stattdessen warteten sie auf die Ankunft von Barry, ausgerüstet mit Fotoapparaten und Videokameras. Ich habe so etwas noch nie erlebt und will mir das Spektakel mal angucken. Irre, wie so ein Naturschauspiel alles andere relativiert. Barry war nur ein tropischer Sturm. Die Stärke eines Hurrikans hat er knapp verfehlt. Doch die Flutwarnungen für Florida gelten weiter, denn die echte Hurrikansaison steht unmittelbar bevor.
Von Barry gehört. Barry ist ein tropischer Sturm, der zieht nach Nordwesten Richtung Tennessee. Und dabei ist heute Abend noch mit schweren Gewittern und Sturm an der Westküste von Florida zu rechnen und auch in Alabama. Dann aber wird der Sturm weiter aufs Landesinnern ziehen und dann gibt es noch richtig kräftigen Regen. Aber dann dürfte spätestens am Donnerstag die Gefahr vorüber sein. Das war's vom Wetter. Ich wünsche Ihnen noch einen schönen Abend.
Running out of steam, but it's still a blowhard, battering trees, buildings and everything else in its path. Barry is also dumping enough rain to set off flash floods warnings as it wobbles across Alabama. Hello, I'm Guillermo Arduino in the International Weather Center. We've been tracking Barry for several days now. The storm first seemed to be headed for Louisiana. Then Barry took a detour and scooted across the Gulf of Mexico. All that warm water was giving Barry more and more muscle. But then, as Ed Lavandera reports, Barry came ashore just shy of hurricane strength.
For all the attention, Tropical Storm Barry didn't take very long to go through Florida's Gulf Coast and head inland. The eye of the season's second tropical storm unleashed its harshest punishment near Panama City in the middle of the night. 70-mile-per-hour winds and heavy rain left several thousand people living in the popular tourist area without electrical power. But it caused only moderate damage before moving through the panhandle into southern Alabama.
I am very surprised. Besides a few little tree branches here and there, it's really not bad at all.
There's a saying on Florida's Gulf Islands that you run from the water and hide from the wind. But Alabama residents learned that you can't run or hide when it comes to trees. You can only hope the trees miss your house completely. Hazel Messer knows she's lucky. A tree which once towered over her house is now being sliced into tiny logs.
Well, I heard something fall, and I come out and look, check, see what it was, and that tree was on my sidewalk. And I was blessed that it didn't hit my house. I just thank God it spared my house.
All over Florala, a town which straddles the Florida-Alabama state line and is about an hour from the coast, crews spent the day cleaning up littered debris. Only a few trees damaged structures. But a few close calls like this are a reminder that tropical storms can always bring punishing weather. Ed Lavandera, CNN, Op, Alabama.
Well, let's see where we have it here. And I don't know if you see the circulation over here. So it's in the state of Alabama. And also, let me zoom in to see if we can see it more closely. And let's see what it's doing at the moment. And besides, you know, remember that once it starts circulating here and interacting with the land, it's going to weaken significantly, and it's already a tropical depression, and then it's going to die down. But still, we have a lot of rain associated with it, so it's over here.
American millionaire adventurer Steve Fossett has entered one of the most dangerous stages of his solo round-the-world balloon flight. He's left Australia and is now over the South Pacific, an area notorious for its unpredictable weather.
Steve Fossett is now clear of dry land and beginning his long and lonely flight over the Pacific Ocean. It's one of the more perilous stages of his solo round-the-world trip. Storms here wrecked a previous bid and almost cost him his life.
Of course, it's a very long way from success, and there's so many obstacles in front of me. I just don't know how to predict the odds. But if I pull it off, I'll be very proud of it.
Fossett's solo spirit is being carried by the wind east. Early problems meant crossing Australia took longer than expected. This next leg over the Pacific could take up to 7 days, providing the balloon can dodge the potentially dangerous thunderstorms. From there, the journey will take Fossett across Chile and Argentina and the South Atlantic. After passing southern Africa and crossing the Indian Ocean, he'll land back in Australia. With his support team watching the weather, the business tycoon's now getting used to life alone in his cabin, coping with altitude and trying to get enough sleep. Nick Thatcher, BBC.
We're currently at T-minus 42 minutes and counting, and operations here at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station are going well this morning for the third launch attempt of the Genesis spacecraft aboard a Delta II launch vehicle. Liftoff is scheduled to occur on time at 12:13 and 40 seconds p.m. Eastern Time today from Launch Complex 17A. The launch window extends for 2 minutes. Air Force weather officials have briefed the launch team that was conducted about 10 o'clock this morning Eastern Time, and they are currently indicating only a 10% chance that weather violations could prohibit launch today. The forecast at launch time calls for scattered clouds, winds at 10 knots from the east, a temperature at 84 degrees, and the only concern is for the very slight possibility of rain showers, but so far nothing has developed. Both of the earlier attempts to launch Genesis last week were scrubbed due to weather reasons. However, today's weather is much better. Again, today's attempt, we're facing only a 10% chance of weather violating our launch constraints. The Genesis primary mission is to collect solar wind particles. Once this is done, the science canister aboard the spacecraft will close, sealing the samples inside, and Genesis will then begin a journey back to Earth and make a dramatic daytime landing at the Air Force's Utah testing and training range. Prior to its return to Earth, the spacecraft will make a flyby of the Earth and loop around the L2 point located on the side of the Earth furthest from the Sun. This flyby takes place in May of 2004, and then later in the year 2004, of course, the sample will be returned to Earth and retrieved. Genesis will be NASA's first sample return mission of this millennium when it captures a piece of the Sun and returns it to Earth. It will travel to a point where the Sun and Earth gravities are balanced, open its collector arrays, and capture elements in the solar wind. Again, launch activities are progressing smoothly this morning. No problems with the vehicle, no problem reported with the spacecraft as it's being monitored, and the weather seems to be lining up with no issues there as well. Launch managers here at the Mission Director Center will continue to be briefed by weather forecasters as they continue to monitor the countdown, which is now at T-minus 39 minutes and counting. In our countdown this morning, we have two planned built-in holds. The first will occur at T-minus 20 minutes, and that will last for 20 minutes. And the second hold will occur at T-minus 4 minutes, and that hold will extend for 10 minutes and 40 seconds, leading us to the opening of our window, which extends for 2 minutes. Again, the opening of the window is at 12, 13, and 40 seconds p.m. today. Again, with everything going well with the vehicle, with the spacecraft, and weather appearing to line up, we are at T-minus 39 minutes and counting. This is Delta Launch Control.
T-minus 33 minutes.
SSE, verify E-package on.
On.
SSE, verify E-package on.
On.
GE, salute charge to 5 mils.
5 mils.
CLCDR, LC-17A, hydraulic enabled to on.
On.
FSC, HPU, on.
On.
Following personnel report ready to continue with the countdown on channel 1. ATC 3.
Ready.
SSC.
Ready.
SCM.
Ready.
SSP.
Ready.
TM 2.
Ready.
ATC 2.
Ready.
Inspector 6.
Ready.
VP.
Ready.
FMA.
Ready.
QAM 3.
Ready.
QAM 2.
Ready.
FSC.
Ready.
TM 1.
Ready.
DST.
Ready.
And RC.
Ready.
Now, this is Delta Launch Control, and the slews of the engines are being conducted right now. This is a final test of the actual movements of the engines that would be necessary to conduct a successful launch. As the vehicle is traveling, the engines will actually be moved as necessary to keep the vehicle on track. The Delta II rocket carrying the Genesis spacecraft is reporting ready to fly from our Launch Complex 17A here at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. The launch again remains set for 12, 13, and 40 seconds. LOX loading has been completed. The countdown is progressing smoothly, and no technical concerns are being addressed by the launch team at this time. The launch operations are being conducted from the Delta Launch Operations Center, just a couple of miles south of the Mission Director's Center. The hypergolic propellants for the Delta second stage have been loaded. That was done a few days ago, and the RP-1 kerosene fuel for the Delta's first stage, as well as the supercooled liquid oxygen, was loaded this morning.
Turn your engines, one down, two up, clockwise roll. Second motion. And returning to null. Null. Turn your engines, one up, two down. Counterclockwise roll. Second motion. And returning to null. Null. Burn your engines pitching up. Second motion to the stop. And returning to null. Null. Burn your engines pitching down. Second motion to the stops. And returning to null. Null. And Vernier is yawing right. Second motion. Returning to null. Null. Vernier is yawing left. Second motion. And returning to null. one down and two up. Clockwise roll. Second motion to the stops. And returning to null. Null. Burn your engines, one up, two down. Counterclockwise roll. Second motion to the stops. And returning to null. Null. Main engine pitching up. Second motion to the stop. And returning to center. Center. Main engine is pitching down. Second motion to the stop. And returning to center. Center. Main engine yawing right. Second motion to the stop. And returning to center. Center. And main engine is yawing left. Second motion to the stop. And returning to center. Center. And the first stage slews are complete.
ED2 is off. Timer reports second stage hydraulic pump turnoff time.
15:15:41.
Reports second stage hydraulic pump runtime duration.
136 seconds.
TM2, report the second stage bleed down time.
10.5.
TM2, deactivate record on chain.
It's complete.
FSE, slew limits off.
Off.
SSE, slew limits off.
Off.
GE, slew charts to 1 mil.
1 mil.
Cycling LOX tank vent. Most of the yard is a prompt one.
Go ahead, sir.
Let you know that the nitrogen and helium, all the K checks are complete and acceptable.
Happy that, sir. Thank you.
And I will be off the net for a minute. I have relief.
Happy.
We're just about a minute away from entering the first of our two holds in this final phase of our countdown. That hold will occur at the T-minus 20-minute mark and extend for 20 minutes.
T-minus 21 minutes. RCO, verify all command areas clear for CRD turn on at T-minus 15 minutes.
RCO verifies.
SYS, disable alarms and average limits for RF link checks. SYS?
That's an order. Okay, average limits and alarms are disabled.
Happy DSC, perform all stages RF link checks and report complete.
Copy and work.
SYS, after completion of RF link checks, enable alarms and average limits and report when complete.
And we are at T-minus 20 minutes and holding. Again, this is a scheduled built-in hold that will extend for 20 minutes. We will come out of the hold at 11:43 a.m. Eastern Time and count down to our second hold at T-minus 4 minutes, where we will stay for 10 minutes and 40 seconds and then come out of that in time for the opening of our window. The spacecraft Genesis and the launch vehicle, neither are working any problems at this time. Everything is fairly quiet here in the Mission Director Center. The weather forecasters are also indicating a very good outlook for our launch opportunity
this afternoon with only a 10% or even less than that chance of any violations due to any kind of weather issues at all. At this time, we will play a short tape that lasts for about a minute of the tower rollback that occurred earlier this morning. Again, this is a shot of the Genesis spacecraft earlier this morning after the tower was rolled back. The Delta II rocket, of course, with the Genesis sitting on top of it, the Delta II rocket was actually moved and lifted to the gantry back on June the 12th, and the next day the three solid rocket boosters arrived at the pad. The Delta II rocket with the three boosters, the second stage, and the Star 37 motor, which consists of the third stage, and then of course sitting on top of the fairing, which is 9.5 feet in diameter, with the Genesis spacecraft inside. And we're back live now with the shot of the Delta II rocket at Launch Complex 17A. Everything continues to proceed smoothly. We are in the midst of our hold at T-minus 20 minutes. No technical issues are being addressed by the launch team at this time. No issues with the Genesis spacecraft are being addressed. And our weather forecasters are indicating a very mild early afternoon here at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. We're looking at some scattered clouds. We're looking at winds from the east at about 10 knots at launch time. Temperature will be in the mid-80s. And basically, we're not anticipating any weather violations at all. In fact, our forecasters are giving us a better than 10% chance of getting, or better than 90% chance of getting off the ground. Our commit criteria, observed conditions, as well as forecast conditions are all indicating green. The upper level winds are well within limits, so everything is lining up for us for a launch early this afternoon at 12:13:40. This is our third attempt to launch this Delta II with the Genesis atop. The two earlier attempts were both postponed due to poor weather. Again, the spacecraft and the vehicle remain in good health. No significant problems, or no problems at all, are being worked in the countdown at this time. Liftoff remains targeted for 12:13:40 from the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, Complex 17A. At T-minus 20 minutes and holding, this is Delta Launch Control.
Timer at the end of the hold, announced T-minus 20 minutes and counting.
T-minus 20 minutes and counting.
CLCDR, remove the red tag from the ORD bus enable.
Removed.
LCDR, ORD enable red tag off.
Off.
LCDR, TC ORD enable on.
On.
SSP, top off second stage helium and nitrogen system pressures prior to the end of the blast built-in hold.
Roger.
ESC, CRD 1 and 2, external power to on.
On.
And we are at T-minus 15 minutes and counting.
6.9. Report second stage fuel tank press. 135.4. Report oxidizer tank cone temp. 62.8. Report second stage helium and N2 pressurization is normal.
Normal.
And SSP, verify second stage helium regulator lockup pressures go.
Go.
SSP, verify second stage nitrogen regulator lockup pressures go.
Go.
HYE, verify first and second stage hydraulics go.
Go.
SSC, report CRD battery voltage is CRD 1.
31.7.
CRD 2.
31.81.
TM2, report CRD AGC voltages for CRD 1.
4.82 places.
And for CRD 2?
4.8.
TM2, report CRD EED ohms for CRD 1.
27.3.
And for CRD 2?
27.3.
SSC, report guidance compartment temp?
69.6.
RCO, report the range status.
Range ready. Cycling LOX tank vent.
Let's see, here we see ourselves getting ready for the C-17. That's our transport from Denver, Colorado to Kennedy Space Center. What you see here is a preparation going on in the aircraft itself. The next picture you see is the shipping container being processed in the PHSF here at here at KSC. Again, you now see the shipping container being pushed into the PHSF, which is where the payload is processed. Here you see the spacecraft with its cover, the solar array stowed, doing this process, building up the spacecraft, installing the SRC, stowing the solar arrays, keeps our processing here at the Cape very short. Here you see a lift of the spacecraft in its flight configuration. This is the configuration that we go onto the launch vehicle in. Here you see a picture. The dark parts that you see of the spacecraft is part of the spacecraft. They're blankets. Your technician is carefully lowering the spacecraft down onto the spin table, which we'll be using to do wet spin after propellant load. This is our... Here we're doing solar array deployment testing, just to ensure that the solar arrays deploy properly on orbit. The central figure that you saw there was the SRC, the sample return capsule. And the individuals you see in back of the solar arrays now are inspecting cables and the solar array wiring to make sure that there's no damage. And here again, you see people taking a more careful look at the solar arrays. One of the elements that we had not installed back at Denver is this particular element. It's called a medium gain antenna. We have one of these that we use on orbit. So this is part of our radio frequency subsystem, a telecom subsystem. Here you see our deployable hinge, a hinge that opens the SRC that we remove before landing. Another shot of the medium gain antenna. And here the spacecraft, still on top of the spin table, in its launch configuration still. And here you see the third stage, the launch vehicle third stage, right below the spacecraft. Spacecraft is being mated with this third stage in preparation for going out to the launch vehicle. And here the canister of the third stage spacecraft combination is being installed. And here's a large lid, a large canister that shields us from environment during transport. It's going over the assembly. And a technician here controlling the activities that are going on.
The Delta II rocket was raised from the transporter out at 17A and lifted into the gantry on June 12th. Very next day, the three solid rocket boosters arrived at the pad. Graphite epoxy motors, or GEMs as they're called, were lifted and mated to the first stage of the Delta II vehicle. Launch processing schedule out at 17A proceeded right on schedule. Major milestones not hindered by any weather or any processing concerns at all, bringing us to a launch ready status today. Delta's second stage was erected on June 15th and made it to the first stage. Here we see the 9.5-foot aluminum fairing being lifted into place, that fairing atop the rocket, shielding the spacecraft as it stands ready for launch today. Here we see one half of that fairing being lifted into place. The Genesis spacecraft arrived at the pad on July 19th to be mated to the Delta launch vehicle. Casing removed, exposing the spacecraft there in the fairing. Ready for flight. Solar arrays in a stowed position, fairing encapsulation following just shortly thereafter. And since that time, the spacecraft, the launch vehicle, have not worked any technical concerns on.
Verify the engine start command is pre-selected by T-minus 5 in order to issue the engine start at T-minus 3. Launch conductor has positioned the TV cameras to monitor the bleeds in the lock start tank throughout liftoff. SSC, calibrate third stage telemetry 2 minutes prior to picking up the count.
Roger.
And SYS and DST, items 11 and 12.
This is Delta Launch Control, and we are 2 minutes from coming out of the hold, and we expect to be transitioning to internal power for the spacecraft. The Genesis spacecraft is scheduled to go to internal power at this time. And we have indications that the spacecraft is indeed transitioning now to internal power, with about 1.5 minutes remaining in this scheduled built-in hold. We are at T-minus 4 minutes and holding. Everything continues on schedule to pick up the count momentarily in the next 90 seconds for an on-time liftoff of the Genesis spacecraft aboard a Boeing Delta II launch vehicle. Launch time again is set for 12, 13, and 40 seconds.
LCDR, this is LVD. You're clear to proceed.
Roger. CLCDR, verify water pressure is 125 plus or minus 25.
It's verified.
FMA, ord latch on.
On.
Personnel, stand by for release of the hold.
And we are on the verge of coming out of the hold. We are at T-minus four minutes and counting. NASA's Genesis is only minutes away from beginning its 20 million mile journey to the solar wind and back to the Earth again. Genesis will continue on a 30-month process of solar particle collection. And then in April 2004, Genesis will depart its location and head back for a flyby of the Earth before returning through the Earth's atmosphere on September in the year 2004. T-minus 3 minutes, 30 seconds, and counting.
T-minus
3 minutes and counting, and NASA and the Boeing launch team have all indicated they are green and go for launch at this time. No issues are being worked.
To open.
Open.
Fuel umbilical purge open.
Open.
FSE, bat 1 and 2 heater controls exit.
Exit.
NSC, report spacecraft is go.
Genesis is go for launch.
Again, everything is reported go for launch, coming up on T-minus 2 minutes. And we are at T-minus 2 minutes and counting.
Prop 1, pressurized first stage LOX tank.
Pressurizing.
Everything is continuing to look good.
110 seconds.
LCDR.
Genesis is powered up and will remain on through the duration of its voyage.
Prop 2, top first stage LOX tank to 100% level.
Topping to 100%.
Everything is continuing to go. Again, the Genesis is powered up and will remain on through the entire duration of its voyage. Monitors are reporting
seconds.
That the spacecraft is indeed go for launch.
External power to on.
The second stage hydraulic pump has been turned on and the vehicle hydraulic pressures are reporting go.
80 seconds.
RCO report range go for launch.
Range go.
LCDR, this is LVD, go for launch.
Roger.
70 seconds.
SSC, hydraulic internal.
The range has reported that they are still go for launch.
60 seconds.
LCDR, countdown limit conditions, T minus 60 seconds to on.
On.
T minus 50 seconds and counting.
45 seconds.
CLCDR, 17A launch enabled to flight.
T-minus 40 seconds and counting. And again, everything continues to look good for our launch today.
35 seconds.
Electronics go.
Hydraulics go.
T-minus 30 seconds. T-minus 20 seconds and counting. 15
seconds. Topping go.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We have ignition, and we have liftoff of NASA's Genesis spacecraft on a mission to retrieve a piece of the sun.
The load relief kick rate is in.
Everything continues to look good.
First stage solid motors reaching their peak chamber pressure. Controls look good. See very little burning or steering activity, picking up a little bit as we go through the wind shears and encounter the transonic buffet. Stage level still looking good, and we've just went supersonic. Controls still looking good as we exceed the supersonic Mach 1. Now passing Max Q. Vehicle first stage still looking good. All three solid motors are starting to taper off. And all three solids have burned out. And there's separation. And solid motor jettison, all three have jettisoned.
Launch conductor OSM on one. We're still waiting for the vehicle to clear the beach.
Genesis is now passing an altitude of 10 nautical miles with a downrange distance 27 nautical miles and a velocity of 2,200 miles per hour. Onboard video system is working perfectly. Coming up on T plus 100 seconds, first stage system still looking good, right at the levels they should be.
Sequencer on channel one. Liftoff time, please.
Vehicle smoothened out considerably.
16, 13, 40.
Decimal?
Decimal 3, 2, 4.
Copy that. 16, 13, 40. Decimal.
Coming up on T plus 130 seconds. And there's LOX tank press. We have activated the bi-level relief reset. And the LOX tank pressure is slowly increasing as expected. Our first stage guidance has come in. Passing T plus 160 seconds. And we are now at an altitude of 27 nautical miles with a downrange distance 85 nautical miles and a velocity of 4,500 miles per hour. Main engine and verniers continue to do well.
Everything continues to look good.
Right at the levels they should be.
Our main engine
stage
cutoff.
Battery's looking good, and propulsion system's looking good.
Main engine cutoff is scheduled to occur at launch plus 4 minutes 24 seconds, coming up in about 1 minute.
A little bit of noise drop out here and there on the data.
No wheel problems being reported.
Passing T plus 220 seconds. We're approximately 40 seconds away from a main engine cutoff.
And we should see that cutoff on our NASA TV camera.
Vehicle's now traveling at an altitude of 44 nautical miles with a downrange distance 197 nautical miles and a velocity of 9,400 miles an hour. And it continues to track down the center of the range corridor. And there's the float switch. We had fuel, LOX, and we have enabled MECO. And there's MECO. First stage has cut off. Both verniers continue to do well. Still burning, and there's VECO. Both verniers have cut off on command.
And we have our first stage separation.
And second stage has ignited, up and running, chamber pressure looking good.
43, 44, 45, 46.
From the telemetry lab here at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, Mark Levine, or Levine, is giving us a real-time call from the Delta Launch Control.
Jettisoned.
And fairing has jettisoned.
A beautiful image on the onboard rocket cam, and we show no sign of recontact for that jettison. Data looks clean. Looks like we had a clean helium reg pressure during that second stage ignition. No sign of oscillations.
And we're continuing.
Okay, second stage systems are up and running. Data is looking good. This is now passing an altitude. altitude of 81 nautical miles with a downrange distance 510 nautical miles and traveling at a velocity of 12,400 miles per hour. And we have been given a liftoff time, range liftoff time of 16 hours, 13 minutes, 40.324 seconds. Now passing T plus 385 seconds. Second stage still burning well. Computer says we've had a LOX depletion cutoff on the first stage with a propellant utilization of 99.82%. We have switched to Antigua data and the data quality looks very good. Second stage systems all at the levels we expect. Too much to report. We're seeing normal roll jet activity as the guidance system maintains vehicle attitude. And we have very little attitude disturbances to speak of during this phase of the mission. And the video cam or video rock mounted on the mini skirt still sending back a wonderful signal, very clear. Now passing T plus 500 seconds. Second stage systems continue to do well. Still have normal roll jet activity, very light. Plenty of nitrogen left on board. Stage systems still at their normal levels. We're just starting to see a little bit of a taper off on the helium reg pressure as expected during this phase of the second stage operation. Second stage electrical systems looking good. Now coming on, T plus 600 seconds, approximately 32 seconds more to go before we shut down the second stage engine.
MS plus 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26.
Take up.
Second
stage engine has cut off on command. Appears that we've had SECO a few seconds early, but well within the 3 sigma. Like about 5 seconds early than expected. energetic first stage. Correction on that SECO time. Looks like we've burned 7 seconds shy of the nominal expected shutdown time. Again, that's within the 3 sigma allowance for a second stage burn. We're now in a normal coast mode. We see the usual jet activity as the vehicle maintains its attitude. All second stage systems are at their normal levels for this phase of the flight. And we have had CRD shut down on command. Both CRDs have switched off as expected. Rates are nulled, and as well as the other rates, pitch and yaw looks normal there.
This is Delta Launch Control at launch plus 12 minutes, 45 seconds, and everything continues to go well. No issues are being reported to the launch team at this time, and telemetry, the telemetry lab here at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station remains very busy taking real-time data from the vehicle as it continues on its path, sending the NASA's Genesis spacecraft toward the sun. At this time, we have entered a coast phase, which will continue for some time, but immediately we're going to replay our launch from various cameras that tracked the vehicle as it launched. Those replays will occur at this time.
13 minutes plus 26, 27, 28, 29, 30.
We're now LOS. We have gone beyond the range of Antigua reception for our telemetry. And that means that we will not see the vehicle again for about another 40 minutes as we mosey over to Australia with an orbital velocity of a little bit under 17,000 miles an hour, and at which time flight commentary will continue.